Dr. Ravichandran has more than two decades of experience in the corporate law and the intellectual property rights related matters. And interestingly, prior to taking up the profession of Cummins Cateries, he has served in the Indian Air Force for 9 years in the technical stream as a trained Russian radar specialist. We all must be amazed that how come he has shifted from the technical stream to this legal stream. And he is doing exceedingly well. His authority on the subject, there is no doubt on that. He holds a diploma in the electronics and radio communication engineering awarded by the Indian Air Force and a diploma in technology awarded by Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. He was also a lecturer in the commerce in Pasighat, working for the government of Arunachal Pradesh for a short period. Dr. Ravichandran, a graduate in law with master's in commerce, earned his doctorate from Algappa University for his thesis titled "A Study on Effectiveness of the Present System of Trial of Offence under the Companies Act 1956 in Protecting the Public Interest." He is a fellow member of the Institute of Cummins Cateries of India and also a member of the Secretarial Standard Board of the Institute of Cummins Cateries of India for quite long time. His area of expertise includes corporate restructuring, protection of intellectual property, alternative dispute resolutions, appearances before all the quasi-judicial bodies for the matters on the corporate laws, intellectual property rights, drafting of the legal petitions, applications covering all the corporate law. Dr. Saab is a prolific writer, speaker. His work has been published in many leading business newspapers, journals, and magazines in India. He has also authored several books. He is a member of INSOL, AIPPI, and the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. Welcome, Dr. K.S. Ravichandran, to this masterclass being organized by the National Law University. We are indeed privileged to have you here with us for guiding the complex subject to all our participants and the professionals who have joined this program. Almost 23 National Law University students have joined this program, and you will be pleased to know that many professionals from the Institute of Cummins Cateries of India Cost Account are also part in this program. I'll request Dr. Kaya to give a short introduction of the today's theme, so that Dr. Ravichandran can start his session.
Good morning to all. My voice is clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please.
Okay. And respected speaker, Dr. Ravichandran, and the program coordinator, Dr. Professor Vishalakshi Madam, and our good friend Guptaji, and all the participants, a very good morning. And it is a great pleasure for me today to discuss on a topic, a combination of substantial law and procedural law under Chapter 16 of the Companies Act, having a title of Prevention on Oppression and Mismanagement. As rightly pointed out, the speaker of the today, in his thesis, he has written on public interest. So, sir has done a lot of research on that area. But I will take maybe 10 to 13 minutes. What are all the areas can be discussed for the future from 2013 onwards? The drafting of legislation leaves the scopes for legal interpretation or judicial interpretation where the bar and bench both are fighting. Say, starting with the title says in Chapter 16, Prevention of Oppression and Mismanagement. when we read the first line in section 241, it says relief for oppression. If we read the whole chapter, we don't find anywhere about the mismanagement. I don't know if it has been misplaced or not, forgotten, or maybe amendment comes. Chapter starts oppression mismanagement, and you can file afterwards relief for oppression, and the whole chapter starts very interestingly, the drafting application for 241. So therefore, it is a procedural clause. You can file a petition for the 241. And it is known to everybody, because as just now I heard, we have the law students and company secretaries, IP professionals. They are given certain circumstances when people can approach tribunal. That is the 241. It says prejudicial to the interest of the company, prejudicial to the public interest, clause 1, 241 clause 1. The new clause which is there, 241 subclass 2, and it is open Pandora box to all the legal luminaries in the field, future judicial interpretation. Because some of the terms which they have been used is very difficult to even to define in Companies Act. I will refer the two provisions. For example, what says the class of shareholders, change in material change, and ownership of the company shares. If something happens in the ownership of the Companies Act, then you can also file a petition under 241. And surprisingly and interestingly, in the present Companies Act, and this is the new, I don't know how many people might have observed, section 216 of the Companies Act talks with regard to the investigation on the ownership of the company. We all read in the company law, the owner of the company is the company in theory, but reality it is the management or the shareholders. So 241 starts with the grounds that what are the grounds you can make as an oppression. It has given for the judicial interpretation by the case by case, where there are a lot of judgments are there, well established. Maybe that during the course of the lecture, the speaker will take on that one. Maybe I will give one exception. One thing is that, and 242 talks about the relief, 244(3) talks on certain agreements, 244 provides who can apply. They have given certain mathematical calculation, a members having particular number of the shares, 100 members are more than 100 or 1/10 of the paid up capital. So more or less borrowed from the section 397 and 398 of the previous Companies Act that has been done in the prevention of oppression mismanagement. Now here, from with this talk, I just want to take one level where all the legal luminaries 2-4 years back or 3 years back discussed about the case of Tata Mystery. When he filed a case on oppression mismanagement, he was having the less percentage of the shares, so the petition was not taken up. Then he has taken a case under the class action suit. Class action suit, which is the new provision introduced in the Companies Act, section 245. Peculiar language, every law student, every company secretary should remember, they are used under the section 245 subclass G. The language says, a member and depositories who can file, the members have not discussed, they say that, we can file a case for damages and compensation. Damages and compensation comes in the law of torts, which is called as a civil wrong. If there is a civil wrong, then you can file a case for the class action suit. If you take about the class action suit history in India, it is not a new concept. Before the Satyam's case, where the class action suit became very famous, because there are different jurisdictions of Australia, US, UK. And we have another case called Union Carbide case, Mass Torts case, where the Mass Torts case comes about the lot of people can file a case, either you can file in India or you can file in abroad, who are the class, and class becomes as a group. So section 245 gives a scope on a topic called class action suit. It has also different names in other jurisdictions, like we called as Mareva injunctions, anti-suit injunctions. That concept has been brought together and included. The gray areas which are there here in section 245, according to me, and everybody says any member and the depositories, but they have given the limit who is a member who can file, like the having 1/5 of the share capital or the depositories or on behalf of the companies. So the law provides the people who can file a case and class action suit. But remedies which are given, either the damages or the compensation, it is again very, very lengthy procedure. When you talk about the compensation, how to quantify the compensation? How to quantify the damages? It is unsolved question in law till today. Because when we are talking about the unsolved questions, whether anybody can file class action suit for damages, something happened in the LG Palmer's case. Immediately when there was something happened civil wrong, and the Honorable Chief Minister has given 1 crore rupees package from the company's side, whether litigation was closed. In Companies Act, whether members, basically this provision is given 241 to 245, which we all read, protection of interest of minority shareholders, protection of interest of the company, best interest of the companies has to be achieved. The best interest of the company, to the best of my knowledge, is that the articles of MOA and articles of association is given as a text, the Bible of the company law. And there is one of the lacuna which I find in company law. I put for all of you to have a discussion on this in the future also. Class of shares, class of members. It is given again discretion in the Companies Act. Under AOA, you can have your own class. But whereas under section 45 and 43, we have class of shareholders with having the DVRs, different voting rights, and the classes of shares. So the class has not been specifically given in the Companies Act. It is again given a scope to the AOA, Articles of Association, who is a class. But again, coming back to the provision is that operational and mismanagement provisions are given for the best management of the company. Number one, it is a provision of substantial law and procedural law. The people can file a petition under section 241 to 244 as a minority shareholder or 1/10 of share capital. Under 245, you can file another petition that is called class action suit. And under 242, it gives rights who can file. So the point here is that all the people are presenting who are here. So that if you want to write a petition, either you take a class action suit or you take about the 241 route, the discretion is given to the members who can file a case. And the jurisprudence started from section, maybe if I am not wrong, the act came 2016, 13. And the tribunals have started functioning from 16 onwards. Now jurisprudence is solely evolving on the class action suits. But whereas we have well established jurisprudence on that one, but the points and language, they have clubbed these so many things. That's what my point is, that why the civil wrong, damages, compensation, quantification of compensation. And when you call about the damages includes in 245, we have one concept called freezing orders. You can freezing on assets and freezing orders with a different word. Now we have one of the case, now we have the new legislation, Economic Offenders Act, where the borrowers are in one country, filed a case in UK jurisdiction, containing the case in UK jurisdiction, none other than the Sri Vijay Malaviya ji. He says it's the company's fault, not my fault. Now orders are getting, people are asking whether he can file a case in some other country. So where companies is established in various places, that is one thing. And under 241 subclass 2, the language which has been used, again, I'm coming back to the 241 subclass 2, one is called about the management and control of the companies. Please remember the language of the control of the company, which is given under 241 subclause number B. We as a teachers, as a company led teacher, when I was teaching Companies Act 1956, control we simply says, who is having 51-49, 75-25, as well as the more than 90-10%, the percentage is calculation. Now that concept has been taken away. They have introduced the principles in company law very indirectly. A person may have 1% share with the voting or without voting. They use a terminology called significant influence. Who can influence the management of the companies, not having the share capital, sitting in the meetings? That's what they call control and management. Two concepts are there. You have chartered accountants and lawyers. I am putting my lawyer perspectives. Whether control has to be taken on mathematical, arithmetical calculation, but that is not given. Control has been defined under the Companies Act. Who can change the material change, decisions of the company, having a significant influence? Who can have a significant influence? There, the share capital capacity is not given. If the MD, so you know, say for example, when the Infosys was in losses, again, Sri Narayan Murthyji came into the board and sitting on the board, but there is somebody who is an MD and having one share or two shares, whether sitting in the meeting, can he influence? There are judgments in private international law. Yes, the presence of the person can influence the judgments. The presence of a person can change the material changes. So therefore, arithmetical calculation of the control and changes in the decisions, that's called the business decisions management of the companies, is being brought directly from the UK private international law principles. They are incorporated in the section 241 clause 2, and section 245 is basically taken from the common law as well as US jurisdiction, which is already providing the class action suit. Now let us hope. Now, because all the practicing lawyers, we require the breadwinners. So all the NCLT cases which are coming either before the NCLT and appellate tribunal, and Tata Mystery has created a lot of event kai, Singh Visar argued where he was not given the that 0.5%. He has came with the class action suit. There are lot of domains which are coming. But my point here is that here we have the Companies Act after the Satyam's case. They are very good thing which they have done. The class action suit brought into India. Even we have under the section 234 of the Companies Act. And unfortunately, one side minorities are given a right. Under somewhere 243, if I am not wrong, minorities are given option, exit option. If you don't like, please leave away. Take the fair value of the shares. One side you are telling protection of interest. Other side you have written under the amalgamation of mergers. Please, minority interest holder, take the fair value of the shares. If you don't like, very politely they have written, very nicely they have drafted. Minority shareholders are given an exit option to exit from the company. That means you leave it. So one side you provide a right to protect. And there is one point I will take 2 minutes, Guptaji, I'll stop it. We have a cases where the promoters who are majority shareholders initial time later becomes the minorities in companies. These people are struggling to protect the interest of the companies. The dilution of the shareholding slowly becomes the founders of the company becomes a minority interest. And they say that we want to protect the best interest of the company. So in order to conclude in 1 minute, some of the gray areas which I am putting, the judicial interpretation, that is prejudicial to the public interest, prejudicial to the interest of the company, and the new points which are introduced is called control of the company, significant influence and change. Let us have a debate. There are a lot of amendments which are coming on that one. Material change, management of the company, change of the business decisions. And under section 245, just I want to throw light about the concept of the damages and the compensation. Why I'm imposing on this? I heard there are law students are here. They may be knowing damages files in the law of tort for civil wrong. A quantum, unliquidated damages and liquidated damages. Damages arising out of contract, damages arising non-out of contract, both can be filed under the class action suits. So with this note, I thank the Vishalakshmi Madam as well as Guptaji and our respected senior speaker and all the participants. So I my thanks to the this program coordinators to give me a small opportunity to share my some of the thoughts. And whatever the doubts you are there, if time permits, I will come and join, but I am always available. And these are the keys which I have opened. And I will again put and emphasize, lot of scope is there in the practice. Please come into the practice of 245 and 241. The sky is the limit for the corporate lawyers, because it allows one more thing also. Multiple jurisdiction cases. The present Companies Act permits, along with the Competition Act. So you can file a case, any jurisdiction which you have an agreement, you can practice all over the world, either in the different jurisdictions. So with this, I will stop my presentation and thank you one and all.
Thank you, Dr. Kundaya, for really setting the tone for the discussion today. You have touched upon various aspects. I think, I don't know whether the time will permit Dr. Ravichandran to touch upon all, but I can promise at some point of time, we'll certainly debate on all these aspects, and we will invite you also in that discussion, and we'll make all the issues flagged, unflagged, and we'll come out with a solution. Quickly, I will just request our program director, Dr. Vishalakshi, to formally welcome and allow us to start the session for today.
Warm welcome and thanks, Dr. K.S. Ravichandran, for your willingness to impart your knowledge and share your experience with the students of national level universities and institutions, especially in the morning time. Similarly, welcome and thanks to Professor Kundaya for your readiness to contribute to this program in spite of a busy schedule. All national law schools are busy in online exams and online classes, and the entire system gets changed. Welcome to the participants. I hope you will derive a sizable benefit from master classes of the dignitaries. Thank you. Warm welcome again. Thank you.
Now I will request Dr. Ravichandran to take the session forward. Sir, I have given you the presenter's right. So if you wish to share the presentation, you can use that. We are available here only, maybe not visible, but you can always connect us. Please, sir.
Good morning to everyone. Hope we are able to hear also, Amit.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Very well.
Whether you are able to see the screen shared here?
Sir, screen we are not able to share. Now okay. It is coming. You can see the screen also. As you wish. This is better.
So very good morning to all the participants, and very thankful to Amit and the professors and HOD, Madam Vishalakshi from NLU Lucknow, and the professor from Bombay, NLU, Chennal Gadda Sahab. Everybody, I'm very happy to have got such a beautiful introduction of the team, as well as introduction of myself, as well as the welcome. It's very nice. In fact, no, these cases of oppression and mismanagement, class action suits, in part, they are not new. For example, when we talk about the cases of oppression and mismanagement, they have been, I can say definitely, they have been in vogue for hundreds of years. whenever you have a corporate form of organization in which under the concept of legal personality, jurisdiction person or legal entity, whatever we call, a person is deemed by a fiction of law, and a corporate becomes an independent person of different structure and stature with its own rights as a natural person. So when such a divorce is there between the persons who are appointed for directors managing the company or managing the affairs of the company, or you have the shareholders who are the owners of the capital, they contribute the long-term funds required for running the business or affairs of the company. Automatically, the moment the thought of divorce between the people who are shareholders or owners of capital, people who are the managers of the running of the management of the affairs of the company and the company itself, it is bound to, in my opinion, see disputes amongst these various, we can say entities in this corporate way of doing business. The company is separate, the directors are separate, shareholders are separate, and everybody is supposed to operate together. That is the kind of situation we are facing. So therefore, the concept of corporate personality has brought within it very beautiful advantages also, but at the same time, inherent in that, in my opinion, is there is always a part of these three structures having some ruptures between them. That is how I would like to put a preface to this particular topic. Secondly, whenever you have an entity which is convenient, on which you can put everything, whether it is good or bad, when you want to have an entity which is available to be blamed for everything, there is always bound to be problems also. See, when actually the directors are the brain of the board of directors collectively form the brain of the corporate. But at the same time, all acts done are that of the company. That is why we have something known as identification principle. You must have heard about this doctrine of identification, where acts done by the directors and managers are identified as the acts of the corporate itself. That means you have an entity, you have a structure which is actually doing everything, and you are only enabling the activities. Therefore, in my opinion, the second important point I would like to say is that the moment you have a corporate structure, it is always possible that the directors and managers do their job, because whatever they do, the ills of that, the problems of that can be attributed to the company itself. And the company is the person who does the crime, does the violation, contravention, etc., etc. And therefore, they always have a tendency to do something which is not desirable, which is not in the best interests of the company itself, because you have somebody else to be blamed. So this is, whenever I talk about corporate personality, I'm seeing these two important things that are coming in the way. That the structure itself is prone to creating disputes. The structure itself is prone to creating ways and means for avenues, for opportunities for frauds and misapplication, diversion, etc., etc. That is the fundamental, fallout of a structure, which is a corporate structure. And therefore, as I told you, time immemorial, we have been having the issues of oppression and mismanagement. The language may be different, but today we are classifying all these things under a bucket called oppression and mismanagement. Suits which are proceedings which are of this nature have been there ever since we saw the corporate form of organization springing up, mushrooming in its growth. So far as our country is concerned, we have heard the 2013 Act, we have the 1913 Act also, we had the 1956 Act also. So fairly for a long period of time, the 1956 Act was ruling the roost. and all of us probably have been familiar with those who have been in practice in the both the decades of 1956 Act as well as the current decade of the 2013 Act. We have heard a fair share of cases being coming up, you can say, from time to time across the country in relation to various oppression and mismanagement related topics and matters. See, that is number one. Number two is when it comes to class action suits. That is a different bucket altogether. Class action suits is a new concept which has come into the system in the 2013 Act. At least I always say that the system has to get mature. It will take time. People, the stakeholders must know that these are all the various structures available. These are all the various remedies available. And they should also be having the courage and confidence to articulate their grievances, identify the options available before them. That is a very important point. You know, it's a corporate law is a special branch of law, though it is a general law with respect to corporate. But there are provisions, for example, professor was saying about the 221 freezing of assets. That is a new provision in the Companies Act. We have always had the provisions relating to inspection, investigation, but definitely 2013 Act has brought the 221 concept of where a creditor, even with rupees 1 lakh due, is entitled to apply to the NCLT and get an order freezing of assets of a company, or a group of company can also be brought in. So there are certain provisions like class action suits, freezing of assets. These are the provisions which have been introduced into the Companies Act. And therefore, first and foremost thing which I always tell is that it is good that we have brought certain provisions which are which were not there under the 1956 Act. And these provisions, the legislature probably has thought it fit in its wisdom that it is necessary in the current reach of the tentacles of the corporate within the country and beyond the country as a multinational corporation when it grows. Therefore, these provisions, the legislature has thought it fit, are important, very necessary in order to have certain situations met adequately. I always say that nowhere there is a blanket ban or bar, or you cannot control it with a vial to stop mischief happening, theft happening, misapplication or misfeasance, diversion of funds happening. After all, you know, we are all human beings. Therefore, there is always the urge to grow in stature, grow in wealth. And that reputation is a big cause of concern. This is the driver of the economic growth, and this is also the driver of the tendencies to achieve that growth and reputation, retain that reputation by all means. That is an important factor we must understand in terms of why such things are happening. Why such things happen despite the need for not to be doing all those things, despite there are so many structures in the governance that are aimed to ensure that there is a control and protection. You have the structure of the board of directors, you have the structure of the committees of directors, you have the structure of the shareholders approving, adopting resolutions, statements, etc. You have the creditors' rights, you have the shareholder rights, you have the regulators, you have the secretarial auditors, you have the financial statements, accounts auditors, you have cost auditors, you have several structures introduced into the Companies Act. Income tax purposes, tax purposes, indirect tax purposes like GST or customs, etc., or for forex purposes. You have created so many structures, and despite those many structures, why do we always witness and visit so many such frauds, so many such big illegalities happening? That is because fundamentally there is the ordinary human being who is tempted towards certain things. That is a temptation which is very difficult to overcome. And in my opinion, I would like to state this as again a preface to my presentation, that these structures had not been there, it would have been free electrons. It would have been uncontrollable. Because of these structures, because of so many audits, because of so many procedures, regulators, etc., everything has been put under control. We are able to work within a controlled environment, and still we see so many liberated atoms creating problems for various people. And therefore, if there had been no such structures and controls and procedures, regulations, and judicial fora, judicial authorities, then you can imagine what would have been the scenario. It would have been completely radical, uncontrolled. And that situation is what is controlled, put under control by these structures. That is number one. Number two is, in relation to matters of oppression and mismanagement, when you talk about, there are certain problems in the system. We are practicing professionals. We are dealing with every day the so-called shareholders and directors and corporate. You have too many things within the companies that. Small company, like 1% company, is a company under the Companies Act. Small company, private company with only 2 shareholders, 2 directors. Maybe you can have 200 members is under the 2013 Act. And you have the unlisted public company, you have the listed company. Even in the listed companies, certain companies are small, and therefore certain governance norms, committees and provisions do not apply to them, even under the listing regulations. And you have the very big corporates. So a range of companies, starting from a 1-person company, small company, to a very big company, corporate, having its tentacles spread across the various countries in the world, everything is now brought under this single piece of legislation called the Companies Act. So therefore, there is a very big opportunity for running from small to the highest level. There is no limit, sky is the limit for the growth. But what we are talking about is the point that there are small people who are also directors, there are small people who are also owners of capital. Even in the smallest unit, there is a dispute, there is a problem. Some people take advantage of their position to control the management of the affairs of the company. Therefore, problems start. Numbers are more in the bottom of the pyramid, with so many small entities coming in. For example, today, you know, the MSME, the criteria for classifying an enterprise as an MSME has been introduced. For example, 1 crore, 5 crore, 10 crore, 50 crore. Like that, you know, they have introduced 50 crore to 50 crore. The investment in plant and machinery, if it is 1 crore and the turnover is 5 crore, it is a micro. Investment is 10 crore, turnover 50 crore, it is a small. Investment is 50 crore in plant and machinery equipment, etc. Turnover 250 crore, it is a medium enterprise. See, MSME classification has gone up, which means whole of the country, several companies are registered under the Companies Act, are going to be of this 250 crore and less bracket. They'll all come under the MSME bracket. Now, in the MSME sector, in the corporate structure, how many of them will be aware of what are their rights as a shareholder? What are their duties as a director? How do they do it? It is not that easy for people of that level who have the desire to do business, who have a run-of-the-mill business operation, who have some, what you can say, active mind to run a business, to take certain risks and to make money. That people, their mind as a business man, that is different from knowledge about having the rights and understood, knowledge about having the remedies understood. Their desire is, their goal is single-minded in pursuit of their goal they will run. their running cannot be stopped. And this entire MSME sector, with so many such companies which will be falling under this particular classification only, because I don't think anybody will be more than 250 crore, number will be very less. I probably feel 80% of the companies registered and operating in India, working in India, must be coming in this bracket. Such being the case, the knowledge levels of the corporate culture, corporate governance, corporate structures, governance structures, and the people who are qualified to sit in the board, they're going to be also of that level only. And therefore, automatically, cases of oppression, mismanagement, if you see, most of the cases will be of these companies which are not very big in size. Numbers of cases you analyze, cases will be of this nature only. You can have a few cases which are big, which can be talked about. You can talk about a case like Tata Mystery. It's a big corporate group. So therefore, top class companies and top class cases may be very, very small in number. In matters of oppression and mismanagement, across the country in several benches of the NCLT, in the 1956 Act before the company law, prior to 1991, 31st May, when high courts had the jurisdiction, before the various high courts of the country, cases had their own stamp, their own capability to lay down a proposition, a principle. The courts do not see which is a small company or big company. They apply the principles. They bring out the juice of it, essence of it. And that is the reason why a person who is like me, professionally, actively practicing in this particular field or branch of law, with an active academic brain, interested in understanding the juice of it, essence of it, and getting pleasure and satisfaction out of it, you will see that there are various principles that are brought up. Number of cases in oppression mismanagement connect only to this particular segment of the companies, which are small in nature, in whatever way you call it, in capital, in turnover, in investment. And the basic problem is that they are not coming here to do business as per the regulations, very tightly controlled. They are not here. Their mind is to do the business, grow the business, achieve the business. And these are all support systems which are secondary in nature, which are given by, okay, if something is required, let us look at a lawyer, let us look at a company secretary, let us look at a chartered accountant, let him put things together and manage it. And therefore, inherently, in this particular system, it is bound to have difficulties. And that is why I always appreciate Companies Act as a beautiful law which has enabled a dispute resolution amongst the shareholders, the group of shareholders, if any, which is in order to ensure that the company prospers. Business of the company is not put in difficulty. That is why we always talk about paramount interests of the company. Why? Because what is the company form of organization? Company form of organization has the characteristic feature of perpetual succession, capable of suing and being sued, capable of owning property, selling, disposing of. Therefore, as a legal entity separate, divorced from its shareholders, directors, company itself is an entity, and this jurisdiction is aligned with the philosophy of the Companies Act to help the companies to survive. In the paramount interest of the company, the decisions are made, disputing parties, disputes are resolved, issues are organized and identified and addressed and remedied with that particular theme, which is called paramount interest of the company. That is the important thing. What is oppression, somebody may ask? What is mismanagement, somebody may ask? As professor was in his theme address saying that he was wondering why the mismanagement is not there in the in the entire 241 to 242. I will come back to that. So therefore, what is oppression, what is mismanagement, what is prejudicial to the member or the person who files the case, what is prejudicial to the company's interest, what jeopardizes the interest of the company, what is prejudicial to public interest? All these aspects will be studied in this particular branch of law. And therefore, I always say Companies Act 2013, or for that matter, the previous company law, is a piece of legislation which is intended to bring peace to the company, which is intended to bring peace to the company, paramount interest of the company. So please understand the scope of the legislative scope that is brought in, legislative objective, laudable objective that has been encrafted in the provisions of the Oppression Mismanagement Chapter 14 or Chapter 16 of the Companies Act. That is the importance of it. Let me tell you, before going into the provisions of the Act, let me tell you a very small case. Most of the Companies Act oppression mismanagement cases will be of this nature only. Most of the cases, Tata mystery type of cases, will be for very, very few. Large number of cases are going to be like this. For example, let me tell you, an example, in the 2013 Act, I don't want to go back to 1956 Act, though I have been practicing in this particular jurisdiction for probably long, ever since I started practice after quitting the Air Force. Now, look at this particular case. A particular person is a founder of the company. It's an interesting case. A particular person is a founder of the company. He subscribes to the memorandum. He himself is the first director of the company. He holds 99% of the capital of the company. He adds one of his friends as a person with some 100 shares, probably 1% shares. These two people join. They run the business. And the business is in a legal process outsourcing job, which means this company does something for a master who is sitting elsewhere in the UK. They do this business. And at one fine point of time, this man, who is the managing director, founder, 99% shareholder, is being invited at the master's place for doing something. So he hands over the administrative works to some of his friends, and he goes to the UK, and there he goes on an employment visa or something, and also he is getting paid there. He runs the company here, and in a remote control, a lot of correspondence every day takes place between the directors, auditors, etc. Now, people in India, now they are in control. So far as company's directorship and management is concerned, somebody who is sitting in UK doesn't know what is happening here, except that he knows what is the business going on. So at one fine morning, suddenly they record. Probably professionals would have helped. They record that this guy has lost his directorship. Remember that earlier Companies Act, 1956 Act, there was a provision which was most often abused for purposes known to them. If a company's director does not attend 3 consecutive meetings in 3 months, 3 consecutive meetings, you can't have it every week and then say no, 3 months, that person loses his office. He vacates the position as a director, 287. So what happened is, there was some record created to show that the person who went to UK had not attended the board meetings, and therefore he lost his directorship. They have recorded some dates and all. And once he is not there as a director, what they have done is, they make allotment of shares. I'm talking about the 1956 Act, but the case developed in 2013 Act. The allotment was made in such a way that his position is reduced from being the 99% shareholder to less than 9% shareholder. So in two meetings in a span of about 15-20 days, they have created the corporate records in such a way that this guy has lost his directorship and his shareholding and control is also lost. He comes to know of it that there is something has happened and corporate records have been filed to remove his directorship and change the shareholding pattern. And thereafter, once the directorship is not there and shareholding is not there, you can't do anything about it. That is a fact. Suppose you don't know about it, you have been sleeping in UK without being bothered about what is happening in India, you may not have come to know at all. Number one. Number two, the corporate records could have been created today, but filed as of 1 year before also it is possible to show that for 1 year you have not been director. This allotment was made long back. Number two. Number three, once that is done, how will you come back? How will you become a director of the company afterwards, which was stripped of you in an illegal way, in a fraudulent way, or in an oppressive way? Shareholding is changed. How will you get back to that? How will you get this shareholding set aside? How will you get back your directorship? How will you remove those people who are the wrongdoers? What is the situation today in the country, or it was prevailing at that time? There was no other way. In fact, I remember vividly that particular date because my daughter was an athlete. We were sitting in Meerut. It was complete winter. Everyone, we were shivering. In fact, we went to the shop and purchased the inner and all, thermal wear. And that time this call comes. So we immediately, I took note of the papers, I dictated a petition, sent it across to my office in Chennai, sitting in Meerut for my daughter's national athletics participation in the central school. She was, that time she was very popular for her high jump. And that time we did this work and sent it across. Therefore the system has only this way of approach. A few minutes back, I appreciated the Companies Act is a beautiful provision where it brings a dispute resolution. It is a piece of legislation that intended to, it is giving peace to the corporate. And now you see whose peace is lost. What happened? You have to file applications in this jurisdiction. You have to go to the Company Law Board or National Company Law Tribunal, depending upon the period. And that time it was Company Law Tribunal, first time created. So, January 2017, in the peak winter, we prepared and filed a petition, and it happened to be in the Hyderabad NCLT. Everybody is new. You don't have the Company Law Board where you had the veterans of the company law who knows all these things and they may be able to grant injunctions. Once originally it was set up in Chennai. Then we have to file the petition in Chennai. Then it moved to Hyderabad. Then arguments were in Hyderabad. All these things. By the time the cases got over and NCLT considered the matter, it took a lot of time. Ultimately, in NCLT Hyderabad, I lost the case, in spite of the fact being so. And in the bargain, several years have passed. Several allotments are made by the new board, and they have reduced from 99 to 9 to 0.9. 3 years, by the time things have changed. Thereafter, then I have to move the NCLAT. My directorship is not restored. Shareholding is not changed. Allotments were not set aside. Lost the matter in NCLT Hyderabad. Then I go to NCLAT. There it took some time because that is also new. Appeal, arguments, adjournments. That the Companies Act 2013 says within 180 days things have to be done is a book, is a matter of statute book. It may not happen in every case, but it definitely happens at a faster pace than what it used to be under the Companies Act 1956. And in NCLAT, I won. The appeal was allowed and all the decisions were set aside. And this. So by the time a person gets back to what he lost, He is a big phenomenal guy. Even if it is 1 year, even if it is 2 years, even if it is 3 years, you can imagine how does he come back? And in a small company, with this particular resolution, dispute resolution clause contained in the statute, you can understand now the reasons why I am saying this, that most of the 80% of the cases must be of this nature, where people would be frequently seeing the allotment of shares, control change, directorship removal. These are all the various things every time it will be happening across the country, again and again. Company will be different, people will be different, subject is same. So by the time you get back, in spite of there being an efficient provision of law, it takes time, and you have to have the resources to fund the lawyers, fund the counsels. Somebody has to be ready to do a business, do a work practice at a low fee in order to achieve a purpose. It's going to be difficult for everybody to bear the cost of litigation and run from one place to another place to another place without any thing in sight. Professor was nicely giving in his theme address, saying that ultimately you see the provisions, it talks about exit of the petitioner. He is correct. That is why I have prefaced my speech, my presentation, by saying that the alignment of this law is to protect the interests of the company, because that is the philosophy of the company now. Perpetual succession, legal, separate legal entity. And therefore, they look at me, and where the majority is in control of the affairs of the company and the minority is not able to see eye to eye, they don't see harmoniously, there is no scope for their living. Irreconcilable difference of opinion has taken place. The easiest solution, in my opinion, is that exit must be given. That is why we always say these type of cases, oppression mismanagement cases, whenever it comes, we always say operation success, patient dies, because he goes out. You might have brought all the evidences, proved it to the satisfaction of the court, winning the confidence of the court, and getting an order that yes, this is oppressive. But ultimately, the result may be the petitioner who took all these efforts is sent out. That is why some people, there are school of thought, like probably the professor has highlighted it very nicely. The school of thought is that should it not be differently dealt with? Okay, we can always sell, okay, let the minority who is oppressed, the majority who is the wrongdoer, be sent out. What will happen to the company? Will the minority who is holding 10%, 5%, etc., the case I have discussed with you is different. You can see the orders of the NCLT and NCLAT, which are reported judgments, which is quoted in several law journals and also in the legal database. You can try to find out a Dictosol case. Dictosol, it is an LPU. But in several cases, what happens is the minority shareholders having 10%, 20%, will they be able to purchase the 80% shareholder? That is the point. What will be the valuation and who will buy? Therefore, in oppression mismanagement jurisdiction, majority of cases, majority wins even if they lose. Majority wins even if they lose, because majority is given the first opportunity to take control of the company, purchase the minority, get into your valuation, find out what is the fair price, give him that price, let him go. And therefore, there is an incentive to doing the oppression. In a way, there is an incentive to doing what you have done and perpetuate the oppression, so that somebody, you trigger that person to go to the tribunal and the person goes out. I'm not talking about 230 to 240. I'm not talking about mergers, scheme of arrangements where minority purchase rights are given, squeeze out provisions are given. I'm talking about oppression mismanagement, chapter 16, 241, 242 cases, where majority will be winning at the end of the day. because they are able to be in seat of power. They are able to have the control over the affairs of the company. They have the wherewithal and wealth to purchase the minority. Understand this particular concept. This is why I said these cases are too many, and most of these cases will have these type of things. This case I have given an illustration because how the provisions of the Companies Act can be utilized to perpetuate an oppressive action, perpetuate a fraudulent action. There are so many such cases where three meetings not done, director is thrown, thereafter happily they do whatever you want, because the person who can always veto is not there. Allot the shares, changes the shareholding, and let us see when it comes. That is the situation today. With this particular illustrative thought in the mind only, I thought I will take you through the provisions which are contained in, let us say, 241 to 245, including 246. During the course of this discussion on the provisions of the Companies Act, we may be able to discuss certain practical cases also. So I'll take you through from 241 to 246. Currently, my opinion is always, what is the law today? What is the law as it is existing today is important. What was there in the 1956 Act or 1913 Act, or what was there in the UK? What was the case in various other countries in this type of jurisdiction? These we can do it probably separately as a researcher, as an academician, whenever required. Today, when you go to the court, today when you see a problem, how it is. For example, if you remember, you have the section 118 of the Companies Act that talks about secretarial standards, a standard or the manner in which the manner, the procedure, the process, everything was set out for board meetings in secretarial standard number one. And you had secretarial standard number two for the general meetings. These were two standards on meetings, board meetings and general meetings, introduced meticulously, taking into account what are the provisions of the Act, what are the different class of companies which apply that, what are the provisions that are there in the regulations or the articles of association, what are the gaps in the entire thing, what are the areas where probably mischiefs are happening, and how to take charge of that, how to ensure that these things do not happen. The Institute of Company Securities of India came out with the secretarial standard one on board meetings and secretarial standard number two on general meetings, issued it under the 118 of the Companies Act, and they become binding. One of the discussions I vividly remember in Delhi we used to have in SS1, SS2, I was a member of the secretarial standard board those days, that if these regulations are introduced like this, it may not be possible for some class of oppression mismanagement cases coming up, because there are a lot of laid down procedures which have to be scrupulously followed by the companies, and they have to be certified by the professionals. So what happens there is that there is a strong reason that number of cases will fall. That was a proposition. Currently, if you see the number of cases that are every day getting filed, I'm not talking about the COVID era, okay? That's a different thing altogether. There is absolutely no respite. Numbers are increasing, ballooning, and things are happening. So, therefore, I always say, you may create any number of structures in any number of cases. Courts may pass strictures, but there is no stopping of those who want to do what they want. They will achieve their purpose and they will see it in the courts. There may be any number of structures, certifications, audits, reportings, regulations, prosecution, penal mechanisms, etc. But are we not seeing frauds happening? Provisions of investigation is there, provisions of freezing of assets is there, lessons from Satyam, Sahara, and everything has come. Serious offenses are created, stringent penal provisions are introduced. Nevertheless, things are happening. For example, I appeared for the State Bank of India consortium against the UB group. The matter I handled was an investigation into the affairs of some of the companies, and Vijay Mallya was a respondent in that case, and it is a reported decision in NCLT Bangalore. I heard that they have gone in appeal against the decision in NCLAT. That was the first case where a 213 petition, investigation into the affairs of the company petition, read with 221, NCLT Bangalore passed an order freezing the assets of some of the respondent companies which are in the UB group. And then, of course, it got into different angle. Then the investigation cases were argued, orders were passed, and then it went to NCLAT. So provisions, by mere provisions and creating structures, output number one is there is not going to be any stopping of any reduction in the outcome of my analysis is that the point number one, stringent mechanism, punishments, increased penalties, huge punishments, like 447, 10 years imprisonment. Number one. Two, efficient structures. For example, NCLT, NCLAT, efficient. Within 180 days, even if it is not 180 days, within 1 year, things are happening. Arbitration, 2015 amendment ke baad, things are efficient under the Arbitration Conciliation Act also. Efficient judicial provisions and structures, governance structures, increase the role of independent directors, audit committees, and NRC nomination deliberation committee, audits, secretarial audits, Companies Act, financial statutory books of account audit, and the duty to report frauds, internal audits, mandatory 138. This is called governance structures. So therefore, A, the entire statute creating a very deterrent, very strong punishment mechanism, creating an administrative judicial mechanism for doing the monitoring, for removing the problems and enforcing the provisions, governance structures, in spite of A, B, C or 1, 2, 3, there is not going to be, in my opinion, any reduction or respite in the cases of oppression, mismanagement, or cases that can be class action suits, or cases which can be investigation, fraud, etc. That is the fundamental output of the present situation, even after the 2013 Act, introduction of the 2013 Act and the system of National Company Law Tribunal, Appellate Tribunal structure. So that is the fundamental one. So keep this thought in mind. Keep the particular case, that illustrative case that I have given, which is going to be the number of cases. That is why I gave that illustration. Moreover, I had argued that case before two levels, at the round one and the round two. And therefore, I referred to that. So keep this in mind. And let us now look at 241. I'm going to say the sections. I'm going to give you some discussion on the definitions, interpretations, principles, etc. I'm going to discuss with you certain judicial precedents which are leading, and let us try to find out if there are some conclusions or takeaways, and I'll be answering the questions, if any, during the course of this few hours or few minutes of presentation. What 241 says? 241 is Basically, see the title, application to the tribunal for relief in the cases of oppression, etc. by a member. Very important. You must remember, it is by a member in the case of oppression. And what is the application? Application is to the tribunal. Tribunal is what? National Company Law Tribunal. For what purpose you make application? You make application for relief. Any member of a company who complains that the affairs of the company have been or being conducted in a manner prejudicial to the public interest, in a manner prejudicial or oppressive to him, or to any other member or members, or in a manner prejudicial to the interests of the company. Three divisions are there, three buckets are there: prejudicial to public interest, prejudicial to the applying member, prejudicial to other members is part of that. The third bucket is prejudicial to the interests of the company. And what you have to show, the affairs of the company are conducted. See the present tense in that. Have been conducted. For some time this is going on, sir. Therefore, the first foremost fundamental requirement for application is A, you must be a member. B, it must relate to the affairs of a company. C, you should be able to show that for some time or now, the affairs are being conducted in a manner prejudicial to A, public interest, or to the member or members, some other member also you can say, or to the company's interest itself is getting jeopardized. So therefore, fundamentally, the law is devised in such a way that a person who is a member alone is entitled to invoking this jurisdiction of the tribunal, which has the power, which has been conferred with the power under 408, to provide relief in cases of oppression. Remember this point. I'll come back to this different buckets again. Then the second part of it. A member is able to complain about something happening there where a material change has taken place in the management or control of the company, which could have happened by alteration of the board of directors, manager, ownership in the company shares. If there is no share capital in its membership, in any other manner whatsoever, and by reason of that change, please remember here that is important. There are two duties. Burden is on the applying member. Show that there is a material change. Go on. Number two, this is in relation to the management or control of the company or in ownership of the company shares. Then the third aspect is important, and by reason of that change, what has happened, that is important. It is likely, the language is beautiful, it is likely, it is not necessary it has happened. It is likely that the affairs of the company will be conducted in a manner prejudicial to its interests, company's interests, or its members, class of members. So therefore, a material change, for example, in the Dectosil case, I have told you, directorship of the founder of the company, promoter of the company, 99% shareholder of the company is removed and shareholding is changed. A material change has been brought about in the ownership in the company shares as well as in the composition of board of directors. A material change which has happened in change in the control over the affairs of the company, change in the management of the affairs of the company, or change in the ownership of shares of the company, and as a result of such change, it is prejudicial to the interest of the company. If somebody starts off like this as a fraudulent, illegal way, Is it not prejudicial to the interest of the company? They can go to any extent. They may do device. I told you in the beginning itself that a corporate structure can be used as a device for achieving certain unwanted, undesirable collateral purposes. So if people start off doing this way, they may use this corporate structure for certain purposes which may be prejudicial to the interests of the company. Or it can be such change, as a result of such change, by reason of such change, that it is prejudicial to the interests of the members. This is the fundamental of 241. Who can apply, I have said, member? To whom you can apply to the tribunal? For what? For getting the relief? In cases of oppression, what are the various things they have broken into ingredients? The ingredients are that the member must be able to show that the affairs of the company have been or conducted in the manner prejudicial to A, public interest, B, prejudicial to the member who is the applicant or other members, and C, prejudicial to the interests of the company itself. The second part of it is if there is a material change, where that material change, the change is in the composition of board of directors, in management or control of the affairs of the company, and or in the ownership of shares, and such a result, the result of such change is likely to be prejudicial to the interests of the company or the members. Therefore, this is what is the ingredients. When I talk about a material change on the slide, I believe you are able to see there is something which is highlighted in red font, not being a change brought about in the interests of any change. You can't go and say it is brought about in the interests of the creditors, debenture holders, shareholders. That change cannot be a talking point in a petition under 241(1). On the ground, there is a material change. Change is brought about for betterment of the company, for protecting the interests of the stakeholders like creditors, shareholders, debenture holders. It's no problem. You must be able to show that the change is material. You must be able to show that the material changes in relation to the affairs, management and control, or the ownership of shares. And it is prejudicial to the, or it is likely to be working prejudicial to the interests of the company, etc. Therefore, 241(1), from the beginning, you must apply thought on this. The jurisdiction of this particular thing has been explained in several cases. There are leading judgments on this, which we will take you through in the course of our presentation. Provided such member has a right to apply under 244. Now comes, I am a member, am I entitled to filing a petition? No, you must be a member having the right to apply under 244. That is important. You must be a member. Once again, you must be a member having a right to apply under 241. This was the talking point in the beginning of Cyrus Mysteries case. Yeah, so many decisions are there. And even under the earlier 1956 Act, we had the consent, we had the right. Similar type of, there must be a member who is having not less than 10% of the capital, or at least he is number-wise, you know, he is not less than 10% of the number of members, or at least he is able to represent 100 members. So this is provided because there cannot be frivolous litigations. A person with one share, he can always create trouble. He can file a petition and put the company's resources to drain. Somebody has to be appointed as a respondent's representative, and they have to go and defend. The matter will go on for months together. So the direction of the management of the company should not be spoiled into a frivolous litigation. Therefore, 241 says, right to apply under 244 is confined to persons who are eligible. That is very important. For example, there was one case where, I'll tell you, very interesting case. The subscribed capital, as per the memorandum of association, by 2 subscribers was 25 lakhs each. The subscription to the memorandum itself is like 2 persons, probably they were thick friends, they joined together, they subscribe. They say, okay, I'll subscribe for 25,000 each. So 25 lakhs. Now subscription was done in somewhere 2007. The matter started an issue, the difference of opinion and problem started in 2012. And the case was very interesting because the balance sheet for all the years, audited financial statements are there. It shows that only 25 lakhs has come to the system. And the very interesting part of it is the petitioner, one person, respondent, another person, both were the subscribers. Company is, of course, a formal party. Both are saying this 25 lakhs is mine. Both are saying I only brought it, the other guy has manipulated it. That case I argued before NCLT as well as NCLT, and it went to Supreme Court also. That case, you will understand, that was fought on the preliminary ground that the person who had applied to the tribunal under 241(1) or that time it was 397, then it went to NCLT, was not a person eligible to apply for it, because a person having shares subscribed to the capital of the company is not important under 240 or 242. That there were only 2 shareholders, therefore the eligibility in a technical way under 244 is not a problem, or 399 is not a problem. The point is, has he paid for his shares? If a person has not paid for the shares he has subscribed, the right is not there unless it is waived under 244. That was another interesting case which went up to Supreme Court from NCLT to NCLAT to Supreme Court. I argued in NCLT as well as in NCLAT, and Supreme Court dismissed the further appeal on that, because the proof of the person having contributed to the subscribed capital was not there. It was an empty petition where he has never had shown to the court that he has brought the money into the company, contributed for the capital he has subscribed for, and therefore he is simply an empty vessel making much noise. Therefore, 244 very thoughtfully introduces, like 399, that a person must be eligible, must have paid for the shares. There must be a vested interest, the right must be there, reflected in the form of this. Otherwise, the all and sundries cannot make frivolous applications and put the company to difficulty by taking the company to the court, the directors to the court, diverting their time and valuable time and attention. In Cyrus Mystery case also, the petitioner never had met the 10% threshold which is mentioned under 244. There was an argument that preference capital cannot be included for this purpose, but unfortunately the law does not distinguish between preference capital and, because there are share capital, there are only 2 kinds of shares, equity shares and shares. And the law talks about issued capital, and therefore there's no question of excluding preferential. There are n number of judgments on this point. Therefore, you understand that 244 fundamental provision is intended to prevent frivolous cases, all and sundries, knocking the doors of the tribunal and putting the resources of the company into difficulty, diverting the attention of the directors. However, the law has thoughtfully introduced the provision for waiver if there are serious allegations. Matters are on evidence, records are speaking for it. The tribunal can waive the whole of the or part of the applicability of the conditions. That is the beauty of law. The legislature has visualized that it is possible. It's not that in 399 such a provision was not there. 399 was operating in a different footing that you must apply to the government. The government has to give waiver, and thereafter you can come back and file the petition. Here, they have put everything in the head of the NCLT to decide whether a prima facie on a reading of the petition and the matters, materials supplied by the, furnished by the petitioner or affidavit, suggests that there is a requirement, there is a serious case requiring intervention, investigation, and indulgence of this tribunal for the reliefs to be granted. Therefore, 241 must be understood to meaning a person with serious case, a member who is ordinary shareholder with a few number of shares without much stake, or a frivolous petition. This is not the forum. Now let me go to the power of the central government. Central government has invoked this power several times. You know the Nirav Modi case. That was the first case under 213 and 221 where government of India is the applicant and a freeze order was obtained. The next was the UB group. Of course, it was a private petition. That was a central government petition. Now under 241(2), central government, if it is with the opinion that the affairs of the company are being conducted in a manner prejudicial to public interest, we see there the central government is not necessary to be a member. Central government applies if it is prejudicial to public interest. If it is prejudicial to public interest, it may itself apply to the tribunal. Therefore, in deserving cases, when big things flare up, central government will intervene. Do you remember the Satyam episode, 408? At the stroke of midnight, an application was filed and the entire board was superseded. Company law board immediately came to the rescue of the government's application, granted an order. If necessary, it is possible for invoking these type of very beautiful provisions in the Companies Act, and they can remove the entire board and change the company. That is the beauty of 241(2). It is not that central government must be showing that I am a member meeting 241, etc. And the matter is only for the prejudicial, wherever it is prejudicial to public interest. It is given. In the opinion of the central government, let us see what are the circumstances. Some circumstances have been very beautifully set out. Class A of subsection 3 of 241. Any person, Amit, everything going well? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Any person concerned in the conduct and management of affairs of the company is or has been in connection therewith. Therewith means the management of affairs of the company. Guilty of fraud, misfeasance, persistent negligence, default in carrying out his obligations and functions. For example, every day there is a boiler blast. Somebody can say there is a persistent negligence. Frequently something is happening. Frequently there is a persistent non-compliance, prosecutions, compounding applications, obligations are not properly carried out. There is a breach of trust, fraud, misfeasance. Each word signifies several things. For each word, we can conduct clauses with cases and illustrations. Business of the company is not or has not been conducted or managed and managed by such person in accordance with sound business principles and prudent commercial practices. Please understand this language. Intervention is possible merely by saying that the business principles and commercial practices are not followed. This may not be invoked by central government in small companies. It may be done in very big companies where there is a governance failure, where there is a resignation of the auditors and independent directors. They come and say, yes, several things are undesirable happening here. It is time the government intervenes. A company is or has been managed and conducted and managed by such person in a manner which is likely to cause or has caused serious injury or damage to the interest of the trade, industry, and business Very large matter this is. Not ordinarily, for example, some GST violation is there, it doesn't mean it is going to be damaging the injuring the interest of the trade industry or business to which such company, it is about a sector. It is about a sector, business to which such company pertains. So again, clause C is not going to be ordinarily invoked. The business of a company is or has been conducted or managed by such person with intent to defraud creditors, members or other person, otherwise for a fraudulent or unlawful purpose or in a manner prejudicial to public interest. Clause A, clause D can be used frequently. The central government may initiate a case against such person, refer the same to the tribunal, request the tribunal to inquire into it, record a decision, this is an important point. Hope the slide is visible.
Yes, sir.
Record a decision as to whether or not such person is a fit and proper person to hold the office of director or any other office connected with the conduct and management of any company. Therefore, when class A or class D, which are the two clauses, in my opinion, government can frequently utilize, forget B and C, which is going to be a very rare of the rarest of the rare cases. Clause A and Clause D can be invoked in several cases of corporate frauds of large scale. The central government will initiate an action, apply to the tribunal, request the tribunal to enquire into the case and record a decision as to whether or not such person is a fit and proper person to hold the office. Director of the company A, any other office, understand, underline this point, any other office connected with the conduct and management of any company. That is a very interesting point, which means if the tribunal renders a decision, finds that Mr. So-and-so is not a fit and proper person, he is not fit to hold the office of director of this company or any other office with the conduct of management of any company, he is finished. He will not be eligible to be appointed in any position, in any office connected with the management of any company. Please see the strength of the word any. The three-letter word communicates many, I will say. There was a case of R versus Secretary of State in the UK, which I used to refer in my research also in those days, and I was doing my doctorate in Aragappa University on public interest. That was a case where the chairman of the company had good number of shares of the company, and he was aware that the financial results are going to be announced and they are not palatable to the investors. Therefore, what he does is, I remember some 300 lakh pounds number of securities he had, he has gifted it to his relative prior to the result was announced. And after gifting the shares to the relative, the relative sells it off in the market, makes money. And thereafter the results were announced, market fell, which was expected, anticipated. Because when the results are not good, market is bound to react. I'm talking about very old case, those days. And this was found to be an insider violation. Proceedings were initiated against the chairman of the company in the UK before the Secretary of State under the company disqualification of directors rules 1996. The chairman, who is known as good man, pleaded before the authorities that he be permitted to act as an accountant in a company, because he knows accounts, he knows books, finance. He is a good in probably commerce, financially literate, we can use, taking the current phrases which is frequently used in the listing regulations in relation to audit committee. So he was pleading that let me be permitted to live as an accountant joining some company, nothing to do with 1996 disqualification of directors rules. A person is declared unfit to be taking part in any company, in any manner, in any position. Therefore, 241, there is a provision which enables a cell government under subsection 2 and 3. And that provision specifically says the tribunal may be requested by the government to record a decision that such and such person is not a fit and proper person, not only to this company, but in any company, in any position relating to the conduct and management of the company. A beautiful provision. The person, subsection 4, the person, of course, the rule of principles of natural justice, audio altum partum. Opportunity shall be given to the person to answer his charges against him. He should be added as a respondent. Application. Every application under subsection 3 shall contain a statement of the circumstances and materials for the conducting of the inquiry and shall be verified in a manner laid down in the code of 1908. Remember NCLT proceedings, I will come back to you separately that CPC doesn't apply. CPC doesn't apply. Here is a case where there is a provision. In whenever, also remember whether it is company law or any other law, arbitration case, conduct, contract case, or commercial case, any other case, whenever you want to plead that there is a fraud, fabrication, fraud, falsification, misapplication, diversion, you must have specifically pleaded in the plaint or petition or complaint that such and such thing has happened in this manner. There must be a specific pleading. The pleading must itself, when read and taken as correct, should reflect what is the fraud, what is the allegation. This is very important. This is a very established civil principle of law, that whenever you talk about frauds, whenever you talk about diversion, etc., etc., those must be pleaded specifically. And you should show that there is a cause for inquiry. Now I will go to the 242.1. I'll come back to mismanagement aspects separately. If on any application made under section 241, if the tribunal is of the opinion that the affairs of the company have been or being conducted in a manner prejudicial or oppressive to any member or members, see 242.1, prejudicial to the member's interest, oppressive of any member, both are included here, prejudicial to the public interest, prejudicial to the interests of the company. All the three are covered with oppressive added. And this is the important clause. These two are together. That is why the conjunction is highlighted separately. The word and is important here. It says, and to wind up the company, NCLT, the tribunal must form an opinion in the light of the finding that the matter, that the affairs of a company are conducted in a manner which is prejudicial or oppressive of members or public interest or to the interests of the company, the tribunal renders a finding. Yes, it is like this. It is prejudicial. Then it should also record a concurrent additional finding that to wind up the company would unfairly prejudice such members or members. Easily what you can do. Why do you conduct business like this? Close it. That is the normal feeling as a common man you and me will be having, is it not? Normally we will think, okay, why should this guy be allowed to run the company in this manner? But this is a jurisdiction which is alternative this thing. So therefore, to wind up the company would be unfairly prejudicing the members who are applicants, because business is going to be stopped. When you can remedy it, when you can remove the people, when you can cancel the contract ceremony, when the powers are discussed under subsection 2, you will come to know that. Therefore, this tribunal In addition to saying that the affairs are conducted in a manner oppressive or prejudicial to the interests of the members or public interest or that of the company, should also say to wind up the company will unfairly prejudice such member or members, but otherwise the facts would justify the making of a winding up order. Yes, winding up order can be probably deemed to be justified in the circumstances. Yes, winding up, which means all that we need to understand is that the drop of a hat, you cannot go to the tribunal. You must be able to establish by facts that the situation is really serious, really alarming, and there is a situation which is of grave concern, that it is justified that a winding up order on that ground is required to be passed, which is just and equitable. The company should be wound up, but the tribunal will form an opinion. Yes, it is justified. Circumstances are very serious. Affairs are very, very horribly conducted. But it to wind up the company would unfairly prejudice such members. And therefore, the tribunal, with a view to bringing matters to an end, whatever is complained of to put an end, make such order as it thinks fit. General provision, make such order as it thinks fit. Supreme power, Supreme Court doesn't have, except in the appeal, subsection 2. Without prejudice to the generality of the powers, the first line itself talks about the last line of subsection 1. Without prejudice to the generality of the powers, which means the powers under 241 make such order as it thinks fit, is a general power, uncontrolled. Ingredients, you should show that the affairs are conducted in a particular manner, oppressive or prejudicial. Ingredient number 2, it should justify, but doing winding up, ordering winding up will unfairly prejudice the member or members. 2 ingredients present, tribunal is enormous powers, wide, without any limitation. In the paramount interest of the company, tribunal is entitled to pass such orders as it may think fit. Now see, the generally the powers are in subsection 1, but specifically guidance is given to the tribunal under 242 subsection 2 in the regulation of the conduct. For example, in future, how this company should be run, what should be the way in which the board must be constituted, what should be the way in which certain things to be done, what are the regulations. Tribunal is entitled to introduce the regulations. The tribunal can ask the purchasing or the shares of any member, purchasing shares or interests of any member or members by other members or by the company. In case of purchase of shares, consequent reduction can be ordered by the tribunal. If suppose company is buying the shares, forget about buyback of shares under the Companies Act. This is different. This is supreme power. Tribunal can say, okay, buy back all the shares of the petitioners or the respondents, majority or minority. Reduction of capital can happen. Company has money, the company can pay off the shareholders and they will be removed from the register of members, and reduction will take place. Tribunal can introduce restrictions relating to transfer, allotment, etc. Shareholding parity can be introduced, proportionate representation can be introduced. Termination, setting aside of modification of any contract can be made. There are some contracts that are fraudulent, illegal, burdensome, which are the cause of all the problems in the company. They can terminate. Termination, setting aside modification of any agreement between company and any person, other than those referred to in Class E. If you see closely Class E and F, in Class E you see managing director, director, manager. In Class F is a general one. In Class F there is a proviso. The proviso says no such termination, setting aside, modification shall be done except after due notice, after consent of the party being obtained. So Class F is for third parties, where you have the proviso which conditions that power. The setting aside of any transfer, delivery of goods, payment, execution, other act relating to the property, made or done by or against the company within 3 months before the date of application. Here you get the law of limitation separately engrafted in class G. When you're talking about setting aside of transfer, delivery of goods, etc., relating to property, 3 months before the date of application under this section, which would, if made or done against an individual, be deemed to be in his insolvency as a fraudulent performance. If a company, for example, today we are all familiar with the insolvency and bankruptcy code 2016. We are all familiar with the challenge transactions which can be challenged, for example, section 43, 44, 45, 46, and so on. If a transaction in a state of insolvency would be treated as a fraudulent preference, you prefer one creditor to the disadvantage of all others when the state of company is an insolvent state. You must be able to understand that the application must be made within 3 months. And the transaction that you are challenging, that you want to be set aside or terminated, etc., etc., must be akin to fraudulent preference. Tribunal can interfere. For example, there is a property. The managing director or the company decides to sell it off. The property is worth 100 crore, you are going to sell it at 50 crores. 50 crore is otherwise pocketed, probably. Within 3 months, challenge. Produce proof, bring data. It's possible. In one of the cases which I argued before the company law board, Balasundaram versus GK, 20 lakhs surcharge was allowed because the property was sold undervalued. It went to High Court also. High Court also did not disturb that particular portion of the law. Clause H, removal of managing director, manager, directors of the company is also possible. Recovery of undue gains made, disgorge provisions. You can establish the diversion of property, diversion of funds, diversion of business, and the director concerned has made money, manager has made money. Disgorge provisions is possible. The manner in which managing director or the manager of the company may be appointed, future, regulating the conduct of affairs of the company. Appointment of such number of directors who may be required by the tribunal to report to the tribunal. In certain cases, for some time they will be required to file affidavits. Imposition of costs and any other matter for which opinion it is just and equitable. So again, provision can be made. So therefore, 241.1 and 241.2 very clearly show big powers, wide powers, no control over that. Control is only that there must be ingredients, there must be company's interest. Two things you have to do. It's a procedural aspect of subsection 3 is that when a tribunal passes an order, the order must be filed within 30 days with the registrar of companies for the consumption of everyone, operates as a constructive notice to everybody. And in relation to subsection 4, it's very important. Subsection 4 is very important. Subsection 4 is granting the powers to the tribunal to pass interim orders. The tribunal may, on the application of any party to the proceeding, make any interim order. So, at the beginning of the proceeding or during the proceeding, if something is happening which has to be stopped, which will cause greater damage if allowed to continue, it is possible that an interim order can be passed. For example, somebody has transferred the shares fraudulently, illegally, forged to transfer, etc., and that person is likely to transfer further. You can ask for an injunction. Or if something is happening which is not in the interest of the company, you can ask for injunction. You can ask for status quo with respect to shareholding pattern. You can ask for status quo with respect to composition of board of directors so that it is not altered. You file a petition, you are a director, the moment you file a petition, there may be a proceeding for removal of yourself at the AGM, EGM in the guise of retirement of directors by rotation and reappointment or removal of directors. Anything can be done. Capital can be increased before any order is passed. Therefore, properties can be disposed of. So injunction against alienation of properties, injunction against protection and preservation, or interim measures of protection, it is possible under subsection 4. And subsection 4 very clearly says two things important. A, the interim order must be for regulating the conduct of the affairs of the company. Number one, while passing such interim order, tribunal can say it is upon such terms and conditions as it appear to be just and equitable for that purpose. Therefore, sweeping orders cannot be passed. What is supposed to be given as final remedy, which is final relief prayed for by the petitioners, cannot be granted upfront without inquiry. Kawasji case, if you read, there are so many judgments in this particular jurisdiction, including G. Kasturi versus Murali. Interim orders for regulating the affairs of the company. You must be able to pass orders with probably prohibitory nature, restrain the company from transferring assets, protect it, preservation, what is available. Status quo shall be, no further ruining, deterioration should not be. So there, for example, some companies, there is a status quo order, not to alienate the properties, but there is a goods which are required to be sold off. Let us say there is a tons of cashew nut is there, which will deteriorate in quality and fall in prices. Order can be passed for sale of the same immediately so that the money is preserved. Application is controlled. So therefore, certain things are for the purpose of regulating the affairs of the company. An interim order in the guise of interim order, final order cannot be passed. Therefore, the law has thought it fit very clearly to say that interim orders for regulating the conduct of affairs of the company may be passed by the tribunal. And it will be like prohibitive in nature, protecting, preserving, nothing more than that. At the conclusion of the hearing, in respect of 241(3), which I told you, Selgraman can make an application, and one can be for declaring somebody as a fit and proper person, not a fit and proper person. The tribunal shall record its decisions, stating therein specifically whether or not the respondent is a fit and proper person. Doesn't mean that central government can only make this application. It does not anywhere suggest that because of 241(2) and 241(3) and 242(4A), it is the central government which alone can make. Central government can make, but nothing prevents the shareholders who are the petitioners from making an application to declare somebody who has probably allegedly committed a fraud from not a fine, you know, that can be declared as not a fit and proper person. Subsection 5, where a tribunal makes an order and that order is for altering the memorandum, articles of association, etc., the company shall not have power. Here a tribunal passes an order, articles are changed, memorandum is changed. Going back, the company cannot render it infructuous or nullify the order of the tribunal. Therefore, protectively, the legislature, subsection 5, says company shall not have power, except to the extent if any permitted in the order, without the leave of the tribunal, to make any alterations inconsistent with the alteration made by the order of the tribunal. It's a very protective provision. 242(6), the alterations made shall have the same effect as if they have been properly done in accordance with the provisions of the Act relating to alteration of articles of association and memorandum of association, and every copy of the order altering shall be within 30 days from the making filed with the, this is a procedural aspect, and there is a provision for prosecution. If a company contravenes the provisions, the company shall be punishable with fine, which shall not be less than 1 lakh rupees, but which may be 25 lakh rupees, and every officer of the company is in default, shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 6 months, or with fine which shall not be less than 25,000 rupees, which may extend to 1 lakh rupees, or with both. Therefore, 242 if an order is made and it is binding on the company, that is why we say it binds on everybody. If it binds on the company, it binds on the shareholders. That is why it is a not a right in personam, right in rem. Normally we say because it is a representative action. Suits of this nature, proceedings of this nature, result in orders being passed that apply to everyone. Thank you. § 243 is a special provision. Consequence of termination, modification of certain agreements. If an agreement is set aside, terminates, etc., etc., such order shall not give rise to any claims whatsoever against the company by any person for any damages, compensation for loss of office. No managing director, director, etc. Remember that 191, remember 202. In addition to that, managing director, director, manager whose agreement is terminated is not entitled to any compensation. The person who is not a fit and proper person, person to 242, subsection 4A, shall not hold the office of director or any other office connected with the conduct and management of the affairs of any company for a period of 5 years from the date of said decision. Of course, central government, with the leave of the tribunal, may permit such person to hold such office even before the expiry of the 5 years. So there may be some reason. He would have brought all the money back. He can apply for lenient consideration. So provision is made for such, but with the leave of the tribunal only, such is possible. Notwithstanding anything contained in any of the provisions of this act or any other law, the time being in force, any contract, memorandum, articles, or the removal of a person shall not be entitled to any compensation for loss or termination, provided tribunal shall not grant leave under this clause, unless notice of intention to apply for leave has been served on the central government, and that government has been given an opportunity of being heard. This is a provision just for the sake of the government wants to oppose it, possible. Any person who knowingly acts as managing director in contravention of this particular provision is punishable with imprisonment, 6 months, or fine with 5 lakh rupees, both. This is an important provision which we read in 241. What is the eligibility? The eligibility is in the case of company with share capital not less than 100 members. Means 100 members having one share each, they can always apply. That is why some circles, company secretaries in practice must be aware, there are people who acquire some 100 shares and transfer it to 100 members so that they are eligible under this particular 244(1). Such cases, on the preliminary, by way of demurrer, at the threshold, it cannot be dismissed. But there may be facts which, on the basis of which, it is possible. And in a private company, yes, there are restrictions relating to transfer shares. But in a public company, shares are freely transferable. So if a person applies for transfer of shares to become 100 member, it may not be possible for the company to refuse to register the share transfers. In the case of a company having share capital, not less than 100 members of the company means 100 members. That's it. It is a number. It doesn't say how many shares do they hold. That is why I said they may each hold only one share. Or not less than 1/10 of the total number of members. Which means if the company has 36 members, 4 members having one share each, can institute a proceeding under 241(2). Whichever is less, or any member or members holding not less than 1/10 of the issued share capital. Here the share capital word is important. Issued share capital of the company. Subject to conditions, the applicants have paid for all the calls and other sums due on their shares. This is a very important point. This is why I referred to the case I fought before the NCLT as well as NCLAT. In both stages I won and the Supreme Court also dismissed. So that is where the requirement is that you must have a skin in the game. You cannot be an ordinary guy, frivolous, making applications, trying to do some collateral purpose, meddling with the affairs of the company and trying to intimidate or something like that. So therefore, 100 members or not less than 1/10 of the number of members are subject to the condition that the applicants have paid all the costs. So issued capital means it is equity as well as preference. There are two kinds of shares. So all these are the takeaway from 244 subsection 1, class A. Class B says in the case of company not having share capital, not less than one, for example, a Section 8 company or Section 25 of the 1956 Act, or a company which is limited by guarantee, there may not be share capital. It may be a company nevertheless, there may be members, and therefore not less than 1/5 of the total number of members, there is a possibility that the tribunal can be approached if the other ingredients relating to the purpose of the application is met, provided the tribunal may, on the application made to is in this behalf, waive all or any of the requirements specified in class A or class B. Therefore, waiver application should be made. It is not going to be so easily granted. The plaint, the petition, the complaint of facts must disclose certain serious things happening in the company which are prejudicial to the interests of the company or prejudicial to the members or public interest, oppressive of members. Then there is a possibility of the tribunal granting the waiver. When I say prejudicial to the interests of the company, ipso facto, it incorporates with it the provisions relating to mismanagement of serious nature. This must be understood in conjunction with the sweeping orders it can pass under 241 as well as 242. Read 242 once more with the various ingredients of the powers. For example, setting aside and termination of contracts relating to managing director, whole-time director, manager, etc. Or third-party contracts, transactions involving commercial dealings, property transactions, goods transactions, disgorge provisions. These things will definitely bring to light that prejudicial to the interests of the company, if so facto, incorporates within it aspects of mismanagement, frauds, misfeasance, misapplication, diversion of funds, position as. So thereby we come to an end of the academic side of oppression and mismanagement provisions. Then you have certain explanations and all given. For example, hundreds of members can join, but they can also give consent to join. There are a lot of cases on how the consent should be. Also read M.C. Duraiswamy versus Sakthi Sugars, wherein it was decided with the Madras High Court in, I think it was in 1980 or something, that the consent should not be mechanical. The person who is giving the consent must have applied his mind. Consent has a meaning. Consent implies ipso facto an application of mind. The person consenting knows what he is consenting to. Then I go to 246. Provisions of section 337, 338, 339, 340, 345 sections. Mutatis mutandis will apply to 241 to 245. So these are all surcharge proceedings, misfeasance proceedings, prosecution can be launched. Fundamentally, these are provisions of the nature to make good the losses caused to the company. To make good the losses caused to the company. Bring back the money. Simple provision. Surcharge means what? Like 1956 Act Schedule 11. Diversion of funds and properties. Disposal of properties for a consideration which is less than the market price. Anything like that. Surcharge proceedings can be initiated against the directors who are accused of misfeasance, misapplication, diversion, etc. Even business could have been diverted. In such cases, these provisions help. Certain definitions I will take you through. For example, needle industries case. Normally, we refer to needle industries case very, very often. Oppression. I will always say oppression is elusive. Very, very difficult to define oppression. It is very elusive, but generally, from various cases that are happening, it will take the form of controlling shareholders, diverting the funds and properties and money of the company. Or minority shareholders are oppressed by majority shareholders, increasing their own control by issue of capital. Or there may be directorships issues also, but generally these are all proceedings of on the foundation of rights of shareholders. In general parlance, 241, 242, directorial compliance will not be entertained. I'll come back to that aspect separately. So what the Supreme Court says is it refers to the other decisions. It suggests to my mind a lack of probity and fair dealing, which must be shocking the conscience of a person. Did he do like that? You must have that type of a feeling in the mind that somebody has done a lack of probity, fair dealing in the affairs of the company, prejudice some portion of its members. It confers, of course, white powers. In Kalinga Tubes case, which is also quite often, which is an older case than the new way, needle industry is a 1980, this is a 1965 case, Supreme Court held, referring to various decisions of the UK courts. It is not enough to show that there is just and equitable cause for the winding up of the company. Though that must be shown as a preliminary to the application, it must further be shown that the conduct of the majority was oppressive of the minority. The conduct must be burdensome, harsh and wrongful. Which means it is, as I told you, the weight of the matter must be established. Ordinary things with mere lack of confidence. I don't like his face, yeah. I don't like the manner in which he is managing the company. This is not the basis of a case. This cannot be the foundation of the case. Mere lack of confidence. 1965, they have said this. And if you read that decision, you will know these are all the propositions of even much earlier to that. Mere lack of confidence between the majority and the minority shareholders would not be enough unless lack of confidence springs from oppression of minority by majority in the management of affairs of the company. And such oppression must involve at least an element of lack of probity on fair dealing to a member in the matter of his, underline these words, proprietary rights as a shareholder, running the company, continuation of office without proper, these are all one or two examples. Public interest, we have seen public interest means what? It's about the way in which, for example, in the current COVID context, something is tested and announced that it is capable of removing. Large volumes are sold, but ultimately it is found to be just a concoction of some small things and water. It has got nothing to do with real medicinal properties. It is a matter of public interest. Public interest has a pervasive way of dealing with everybody, affecting the lives of people. It can cause damage and danger to the society. Outside. That is why when I wrote my article on corporate governance recently in the Chartered Secretary, I have said governance is not about persons with which the company is dealing, persons who own the shares of the company, persons who are the directors of the company, persons who are creditors, debtors. No. It is beyond. It goes to the environment, it goes to the people around, it goes to the atmosphere, it goes to the things, plants, beings. So public interest is something which goes outside the company and affects a lot of people. So such type of things can be brought in the term public interest. You can see Black's Law Dictionary, which defines public interest. One second.
You want anything?
Yeah, I'm just searching. Not this one. Okay, I'll get back to you again. This is only just a dictionary meaning of the expression public interest, which is often quoted in courts. Hope this screen is visible.
Yes, sir. Please.
Now, this is a very interesting provision. You know, investigation under 213 is always usually this investigation. I have got so many cases I have argued against, you know, in the field of investigation, including the UB Group case. This is very useful provision. It's very interesting because investigation cases spring from frauds, mismanagement, illegality, and all. Persistent default in compliance can be a matter of investigation. Read sporting pastime. In Motha Brothers versus Calcutta Landing and Shipping Company, Calcutta High Court in 1969 said, vague and uncertain allegations of management oppression, although constitute grounds for suspicion, do not entitle the petitioner to ask for an investigation. So basically, even for a very, very preliminary oppression case, nature of allegations must be serious enough. It should not be mere lack of confidence. And you are talking about investigation. The highlighted portion I will read again. If the petitioner fails to set out the facts and produce sufficient satisfactory proof in support of those facts, no order for investigation can be made. A shareholder has no right to access books of the company, but denial of access is not an act of oppression. If the petitioner cannot make out a case of mismanagement or oppression and oppression because he was unable to collect materials for that purpose, normally shareholders will come and tell us this only. Sir, we cannot get materials because we are getting once in a year the annual reports, and what is there in the annual report only we, if you go and ask the directors to give the books, are they going to give? No. Unless the person who is the complaining member is also a director, he goes to the company, says, I want the books to be inspected, I want to, it is the right of the, you know, that 128 or the earlier 209 provides right of inspection to the directors, so long as the person is a director. So if a petitioner says, I am unable to make out a case of mismanagement because I am not able to collect materials, no, no, no. It is not for the court to direct the company to offer inspection of the company's books of account to enable the petitioner to collect materials. In one of the cases I am currently arguing, you want an audit, forensic audit, independent audit, and you are saying falana falana illegality, violation, removal of money and all. You first show that there is illegality and misappropriation. You first establish by facts on the basis of your pleadings and papers that there is a diversion, misappropriation, misfeasance, theft, whatever it is. You cannot order, ask for an order to investigate, appoint forensic, etc. And for the purpose of getting information, petitioning shareholders cannot come and say, sir, I am unable to collect materials, can we do something about it? No. There must be a paper, there must be a record, there must be an evidence. Prima facie, it should be capable of proving that the all is not well. The all is not well is not a slogan. Is supposed to be supported by materials, so that springing from there, it can be presumed that there are larger things will emerge. There may be many other skeletons in the cupboard. Looking pehle aapko to ek kam se kam you have to show one or two skeletons in the board, in the cupboard. Therefore, You cannot come and say, because I am unable to collect materials for this purpose. It is not the court to direct the directors of the company to offer inspection of the company's books and accounts to enable the petitioner to collect materials for the petition under 319, or to direct investigation to the affairs of the company and accounts by an independent person to bring out materials for further orders against the company directors and shareholders. Calcutta High Court, 1969. Very interesting decision, practically used. What are the four important factors while dealing with cases of oppression mismanagement? First and foremost, let us understand the duties. Until 2013 Act came into force, nobody wrote any duty in the statute book. What is the duty of a director? Anybody will ordinarily say a director is expected to act in good faith for the paramount interests of the company. Bona fide act in good faith. For what? For the interests of the company. Simple rule. What is good faith? Take Limitation Act 1963. Or take the General Clauses Act or IPC. What does they say? What do they say? They say honestly as acted. Negligently is different. Honestly. Limitation Act. Taking an action with due care and diligence. Therefore, what is the duty of a director? It's very simple. He is supposed to act in accordance with the act, applicable law, in terms of the charter documents of the company, memorandum articles of the company, in good faith, for the bona fide interests of the company, genuinely, honestly, with due diligence, care, which is expected of you. General, this is what is the duty of the director. 166 was introduced in the statute book, laying down that he shall not do this, that, and all. First and foremost in this particular branch of law in jurisdiction is governance. And governance is founded on the basis of the duties of directors and scope of their provision. Fiduciary duties, if they violate, there is a cause of concern. Directors owe a duty to act in good faith for bona fide interests of the company. If they act otherwise, their acts could be brought to scrutiny. Shareholders are not powerless. Shareholders can approach the tribunal and very well bring the acts of directors which are undesirable, which are unacceptable, which are unbecoming, which are violation of fiduciary duties. One should clearly know the rights of shareholders in this jurisdiction. In this jurisdiction, rights of shareholders is important. LIC versus Escorts, para number 84. What are the rights of shareholders? Everybody knows right to receive dividends, right to receive annual reports, right to attend AGMs, notice of general body, right to vote there. General rights. You take the case of Bacha Gulsar, Commissioner of Income Tax. Shareholder is not a person who is entitled to any proportionate property except in winding up. Long back, these things were decided. Even before that, these principles were always, you know, right from Solomon case. So rights of shareholders is important. I remember Sanjeev Banerjee in Calcutta High Court, in I think Capricorn Mills case or something, beautifully he said, 10% shareholding, you have certain rights. 26% shareholding, you have certain rights. The majority shareholders cannot, without your consent, pass special resolutions. In fact, in one of the cases I fought before the Company Law Board and NCLT, the shareholders were able to alter the capital, increase the capital, because already all the authorized capital was exhausted. But there was a fight between the groups in the company. The majority group wanted to alter the capital. They cannot issue further shares unless authorized capital is increased. And authorized capital cannot be increased unless capital clause is amended. Corresponding clause in the Articles of Association is amended. Companies Act says memorandum can be altered by an ordinary resolution, the capital clause of the memorandum. But articles have require special resolution. In this case, the special resolution could not be passed because 26% was with the complaining shareholders, minority shareholders. However, the company went ahead and discarded the requirement of articles alteration, altered only the memorandum, deferred the articles of association, and increased the capital. I was able to present it to the court and get an order freezing the voting rights on the increased capital. Suspension of voting rights. Majority may use the powers in different ways, and 10% shareholders, 26% shareholders, 75%, 76% shareholders, different ways of 90% shareholders. Squeeze out provisions, the remaining 10% can be purchased. Therefore, a person may be having only one share, a person may be having 90% shares, 100% shares. There are different rights, which are individual rights, which are corporate rights, which come to you because you are eligible under 244. You are eligible to ask for a requisition to EGM. So that is how the Companies Act is structured. For example, I remember very vividly a particular case where I was representing a person having 100 shares only. The remaining 6,65,900 shares was with a company whose place of registered office is UK. So it was almost like a wholly owned subsidiary. And I was representing the 100 share wala. That is because in that case, the holding company in the UK went into receivership. And the receivers were administrative receivers. And they sold off the entire Indian assets to a relative of a director for £1. Whole of Indian business was sold by the receivers for just £1 to a relative of a director of the holding company. I argued situs of the shares is in India. Therefore, the jurisdiction of the company law board is there, number one. Number two, I may be only 100 shareholder, but if you want to transfer the rest of the shares under articles, I have the preemptive right, right of preemptive. Of course, the company law board allowed the maintainability on these grounds that situs is in India, shares are issued in India, the registered office of the company is in India, therefore company law board has jurisdiction. But dismissed the petition before even it was argued on merits, probably due to some reason, I don't know at all, but it went in appeal in Madras High Court. Madras High Court set aside everything. So, rights of shareholders is important. In such a situation, even a 100 shareholder, a member having only 100 shares, could be a person entitled to shareholder company. One must understand very importantly the proposition, perfectly illegal act may not be struck down, while a perfectly legal act may be set aside by the NCLT under 248. Let me see if I'm able to share the screen. Is there some difficulty in this? Let us see this very interesting proposition. This is page number 20. Let me go to the beginning. Please see this decision. 18th. Amit, this screen is visible, no?
No, now it's again.
Not visible?
No, sir, no.
Oh. Now?
Yeah, now it is
Okay. So this is a decision of the Gujarat High Court. I love reading this decision again and again. You see, this is in 1964. I was a bacha that time, infant. And it was by eminent jurist P.N. Bhagwati. You remember Bhagwati was the person who headed the takeover panel first time in India. P.N. Bhagwati, eminent jurist. Let me now go to the relevant paragraph for our purpose. Of course, it is not a proper subject matter of inquiry in relation to petitions under section 397-98, that is oppression, mismanagement 241-242, to consider whether a particular action of the shareholders, I will zoom it also a little more for people to see, to consider whether a particular action of the directors or controlling shareholders is illegal, invalid, not binding as being violation of provisions of law. Illegal, invalidity, not binding. The only question with which the court is concerned in such a petition is whether the action of the directors or controlling shareholders is oppressive to the minority shareholders, or is it prejudicial to the minority shareholders or prejudicial to the interests of the company. A particular action of the directors and controlling shareholders in violation of provisions of law, in the sense that some particular provision may not have been complied with. We have to understand that, okay, he has not followed a particular provision, resolution is not passed, is filed. This is not important. Is the action interest of the company, or is it oppressive, is it prejudicial? This is the decision P.N. Bhagwati Sahab has given 1964. A particular action of the directors or controlling shareholders may be in violation of the provisions of law, in the sense that some particular provision of law may not have been complied with before such action, or yet such action may be very much interest of the company. On the other hand, another action of the controlling shareholders may be wholly within the limits of the law. See the beautiful provision that has been captured here. On the other hand, another action can be perfectly in accordance with law, but it is oppressive. Probably, let me say, I have followed section 62, section 42, allotted shares. Majority shareholders have brought the consideration. Price was determined for valuation. Shares are allotted to them. Their stake is into minority, is reduced to further minority. Control is lost. Perfectly, they can show compliance. However, it may be oppressive to the minority shareholder. If it is prejudicial, it can be prejudicial. Therefore, P.N. Bhagwati says, what the court is concerned to inquire in a petition under 397-98 of the Companies Act is whether the action of the directors or controlling shareholders complained of is such that it can be said that the affairs of the company are conducted in a manner oppressive of the minority shareholders or prejudicial to the interests of the company. Therefore, a mere allegation that so-and-so resolution is illegal, invalid, not binding on the company is of no consequence. In fact, this decision is always referred to, even in the case of explanatory statement. If you see the provisions of the Companies Act, like 173 or 102, a statement explaining the resolutions placed before the shareholders must be always there, and it should explain the entire set of facts, including disclosure of interests and concerns. And this decision says, Justice P.N. Bhagwati in this decision clearly says, explanatory statement invalid, it is fatal. Badiya, okay? I mean, the decision is also very good. The explanatory statement, if it is not there, it is fatal to the resolution. If it fails to say material facts, it is fatal. The resolution is invalid. That is this decision. Very important decision. The point I am trying to tell you is, that a perfectly legal, validly conducted proceeding could be declared as oppressive or prejudicial to the interests of the company, and illegal non-compliance is proved, yet the court may not set aside that on the ground that there is nothing oppressive of shareholders. When I was talking to you on the Needle Industries case, please see here, the court in para number 108 Supreme Court says, the principle that is primarily the power is given to enable capital to be raised for the purposes of the company, there may be occasions when directors may fairly and properly issue the shares. Therefore, what we need to, whenever we attack allotment of shares, on the respondent side, they owe a duty to show doctrine of proper purpose. The allotment was for the proper purposes of the company. For example, maintaining control in the hands of directors, an inquiry whether additional capital was specifically required is often most relevant to the ultimate question of the validity, invalidity. But the ultimate question must always be whether truth in issue is made, whether the issue was made honestly in the interest of the company. When directors of a company seek, where directors of a company seek before by entering into an agreement to issue shares, to prevent a majority shareholders from exercising control of the company, they will not be held to have failed in their fiduciary duty if they act in good faith in what they believe on reasonable grounds to be in the interest of the company. If the director's primary purpose, this is a very important sentence in issue of shares, if the director's primary purpose is the interests of the company, they are acting in good faith, even though they also benefit, incidentally, they may benefit, their shareholding would have gone up by 1%, 2%, some percentage. But if it is in the interest of the company, you can't do anything about it. So that is how we must look at it in this particular screen. Now I'll come back to my PowerPoint presentation. Hope you are able to see the screen.
Yes, sir, please.
So the object of this particular provision is, it is an alternate to winding up. Winding up is not the intention, it is alternate to winding up. It would be in the interest of the shareholders of the company if the company was allowed to continue under such directions as the court may consider proper in a given case, instead of ordering a winding up. If the affairs of the company are such, what the court has said is, I am talking about exceptions in Foss and Harbottle is referred to, killing a company would be a cruel method of ending oppression mismanagement. This is the principle, fundamentally. It would not serve the interests of the minority shareholders. The legislature has thought it fit to introduce provisions to operate as an alternative to winding up. As an alternative to winding up, though circumstances will show that it is winding up is just and equitable. Clean hands. This is very important. Always we used to say, the petitioning shareholders are also not people who have descended, angels descended from heaven. They may have their own stories, which the respondents will point out, because this is an equitable relief. You know, the person who is approaching must approach the tribunal under this jurisdiction in good faith. He must come with clean hand. We used to say, he who comes with unclean hands is not entitled to equitable relief. Now, that is why, before entering the NCLT, sanitizer is kept. You can always clean your hands and go. The point is, one who comes to court must come with clean hands, means he should not be a fraudster. The respondent should not be seen as saying, it is a case of kettle calling the pot black. You are already a person who has indulged in frauds and fabrication, and you come and say something here. This is an equitable relief. Therefore, he who comes to seek aid of the equity must have conducted himself properly. It's a very important proposition. People must remember, he who comes to court must come with clean hands. Fiduciary duties. I have already told you, Dale and Carrington, this decision we always use, Supreme Court. Dale and Carrington, a company is a juristic person. It acts through directors who are collectively known as BOD, Board of Directors. An individual director has no power to act on behalf of the company, which is a director, unless the resolution authorizes him, for example, MD, etc. Whatever decisions are taken regarding running of the office, they are taken by the board. The directors of companies have been variously described as agents, trustees, representatives. But one thing is certain, that the directors act on behalf of the company in a fiduciary capacity. Their acts and deeds have to be for the benefit of the company. They are agents of the company to the extent they have been authorized to perform certain acts. In a limited sense, they are. Of course, this decision was distinguished in Sangram Singh. Subsequently, Supreme Court decision in Dale and Carrington, I think Justice Ruma Paul was a member of this decision. Thereafter, it went to Sangram Singh. They have clarified that you can't say that they are trustees of shareholders of the company. Sangram Singh and Dale and Carrington, you read together always. So coming to Sangram Singh, the Supreme Court clarified the ratio in Dale and Carrington must be understood to have been rendered in the factual situation. In Dale and Carrington, we normally use the Dale and Carrington and tell that the affairs of a private company must be tested on a much finer scale. Affairs of a private company. Why that decision came was, you remember under the 1956 Act, whenever rights issue is made or whenever a share issue is made, a special resolution is possible for issuing shares to somebody other than by way of rights. But that was provision applicable to public company. So in private company, majority directors can issue shares to the exclusion of the minority. Dale and Carrington said, no, affairs of a private company, more in the nature of a partnership, must be tested on much finer scale. Beautiful proposition laid down in Dale and Carrington. Leaving aside that for a minute, coming to position of directors, Dale and Carrington ratio was clarified in Sangram Singh High Court case, saying the ratio in Dale and Carrington must be understood to have been rendered in the factual situation obtaining in that case. It doesn't lay down a law as a law. Fiduciary duty of director extends to shareholders so as to entitle him of being informed of all decisions by the board. Companies Act is very clear what are to be told to the shareholders at the AGM, what is to be laid before the AGM for adoption of accounts, etc. Such a broad proposition of law, if understood, have been laid down in Dale and Carrington, would be inconsistent, Supreme Court says, in the subsequent decision. With the duty of the director vis-a-vis the company and the settled law is statutory duty of the director is primarily to look after the interests of the company. Therefore, the Supreme Court said, director's position is very important. That is, in these cases, in this branch of law, these are all the things which will frequently come up. Partnership principles. In closely held family companies, small private companies, principles of partnership, which means every decision must be unanimously taken. Each partner owes a duty to other. Everybody takes unanimous decision means, you know, some other partners cannot take advantage of whatever business opportunities that come to him, allot shares to him. Therefore, in oppression mismanagement cases, partnership principles can also be invoked. Equitable relief, I have already told you, there is a case in Elder versus Elder is very more succinctly, it may be said, complaining shareholders must be under a burden, which is to show that it is the conduct of the respondents is unjust, harsh, tyrannical, lack of probity, lack of fair dealing in the affairs of the company. Even Abraham E. versus Westbourne Galleries also, it's a very interesting decision on partnership principles. When partners have fallen out, for example, perfect deadlock you take. A deadlock, which is a perfect deadlock, is I hold 50, you hold 50. Both of us do not see eye to eye. We don't want to sit in a coffee shop, even in different tables. Such a situation, the only relief that quite a court can grant is one can sell the other, sell his stake to the other, or both of them can sell the stake to somebody else, or the company can do one. What else you can bring in a perfect deadlock? Ibrahimi versus Westbourne Galleries is a very frequently often quoted judgment. Any breach of good faith which the petitioners and respondents owed to each other, sponsorship principles, would entitle the petitioners for an order of the winding up on just and equal grounds, and therefore alternatively there is a safeguard to safeguard the interests of the company and shareholders. This I have already explained to you, taking from Justice P. N. Bhagwati's judgment as well as Needle Industries. And there are n number of judgments on this point that perfectly illegal, yet it could not be set aside because there is nothing oppressive or prejudicial interests of the shareholders and the company. These are all the various things which have always come up, all the meetings, notices, attendance, registration proof, secretary standard, you just remember, everything is properly given. That is followed is the question. Not followed, followed will be cases. Attendance registers, minutes of meeting, books of accounts, statutory registers, records, forms, returns, certifications, correspondence, legal notices, replies, pleadings, in parallel proceedings, all these things may be required to be produced to answer charges. Decisions. Needle Industries, I have already said. Shanti Prasad Jain, Kalinga Tubes, I have already said. Nanalal Jewel, Bombay Life Assurance Company. Mistake is there in the title. I'll correct it first because it says Bombay Life. It was held that if the directors exercise their power for the benefit of the company, court will not interfere. Palghat Exports, it's a very interesting decision of the Kerala High Court. If the object of the petition is to recover money from the controlling shareholders, it is an abuse of process. Booz Allen, it is a very different judgment here. That is on the arbitration. I will get back to you separately on that. What are the wide powers of the court? Sangram Singh, we have discussed already. These are all the various decisions which probably you can look at it. Item number 11 is Arunachalam versus Sugavaneshwara is a case I have argued because Arunachalam had filed the first round petition and he has argued his case, and second round he came again. Then I said that he is estopped from bringing back the matters which were already the subject matter of the earlier petition, and the court found his conduct was what I can say, the court wrote the words, the conduct of the petitioner was irritating in nature and the cost was awarded. Class action suits, as I already, professor in the theme address has explained, is a very new provision. It brings a limited extent class action is brought into the statute book under the company. As he rightly said, the purpose of these proceedings is to get compensation awarded or to bring back, disgorge losses back to the company. It's like a civil remedy where some loss is caused, you bring it back, indemnify the company, make good the losses. Member, such number of member or members, depositor or depositors, or any class of them, there is, if they find that there is something which is prejudicial to the interest of the company or depositors or members, they can file and ask for various orders, A to F it is there. One is Ultra Vires Act. Company can be restrained from acting. Company can be restrained from committing breach of provisions of the company's memorandum and articles. A resolution, to declare a resolution altering is void, it is possible. To restrain the company from acting on resolution. Next is important, clause E, read as a shareholder. Clause E, to restrain a company from doing an act which is contrary to the provisions of the act. Recently before NCLAT, a question came whether preference shareholders can invoke the class action suits under clause F because their preference shares are not redeemed, the company is not going to the tribunal for extension of time. All these things. And if preference shares are not redeemed within 20 years, it is contrary to the provisions of the Act. Clause F, to restrain the company from taking any action contrary to any resolution, which means the regulations passed by the members. To claim damages, this is what a professor was mentioning, to claim damages, compensation or demand, any other suitable action from or against the company directors for fraudulent, unlawful, wrongful act, omission or conduct, including auditors. The auditors also can be brought as a defendant in these actions. It's very important, as I told you, the fundamental principle is that any irregularity, fraud, illegality, wrongful act, omission, commission, all those things can be arrested by specified number of members or depositors. Of course, this jurisdiction is evolving, it is maturing, in my opinion, over a period of time, once large number of cases come up, big cases are there. There may be some reason to expand the scope of this particular jurisdiction. As I told you, as of now, 80% of the cases are small cases, small companies, MSME bracket companies only. Transaction suit is a new concept. We have to see it under company law. It should emerge as a thing. And for that, we need vigilant shareholders, very perfectly poised professionals. Governance structure must function. Then it will. Where members, depositors seek any damages or compensation or demand any other suitable action against audit firm, the liability of the firm shall be, as well as each partner who is involved in making the improper misleading statement with the particulars of the audit report or who acted fraudulently, unlawfully, wrongfully. It is also what is the requisite number of depositors, requisite number of members is provided in subsection 3. In subsection 4, the tribunal takes into account various things, including the evidences, etc. I'm not, for want of time, taking you through all these things. In the application, tribunal will see whether public notice is given. Similar applications in any other jurisdiction, if it is there. Two class of action applications shall not be allowed. All those things are very practical provisions. These are all the various provisions, but subsection 8 you can read there. Frivolous, vexatious, if it is there, cost not exceeding 1 lakh rupees is liable to be levied on that. It's very important. Then there is another class of things, which will be in 5 minutes, I will close this particular subject. Arbitration agreements. Today in the commercial world, in most of the cases, agreements between shareholders talk about shareholding parity, joint venture agreements, shareholder rights agreements, investment agreements, memorandum of understanding, everything provided arbitration. Are all the disputes in the subject matter covered by the agreement or contract? Therefore, normally in operational mismanagement matters, Section 8 of the Arbitration Conciliation Act will be used by the respondents, saying that petitioners are not supposed to invoke this jurisdiction. Petitioners have to necessarily fall in line with the agreed private dispute resolution agreement between the parties. Therefore, Section 8 application under the Arbitration Conciliation Act they will file, which Section 8 says if there is an arbitration agreement, if the parties are same, if subject matter is same, then court or the judicial authority like the NCLT is liable to return the plaint. Say that you go on, dismiss the case and then say that, okay, you go and resolve the dispute through the arbitration, which is what you wanted. If you see Section 5 of the Arbitration Act, supremacy of arbitration agreement between the parties must be given precedence. It is the fundamental purpose of Arbitration Act. But normally, in the oppression mismanagement cases, the pleading that is taken against Section 8 will be, against Section 8 will be, subject matter is different, parties are different, this is a statutory right, relief granted is statutory, right in rem, not right in personam. These are all the various things normally. So therefore, we have to see the following things. Anand Galpati Rao case, Supreme Court decided that the arbitration agreement should be there. The party to the agreement brings an action in a court against the other party, but subject matter is same as the arbitration agreement. Therefore, Section 8 application is taken, and that too before the counter is filed, before the first statement on substance of dispute. Sukanya Holdings, another very often quoted decision, which says that the entire gamut of the dispute is that where party falls within the domain of the arbitration. The rest is triable in civil court, and also in which parties are not same as they were in the arbitration agreement. In such a situation also, splitting cause of action, the court should continue with the suit. So if the court is, when considering Section 8, court finds parties are different, subject matter is different, Sukanya can be used. Booz Allen is decision where certain disputes, certain subject matters are non-arbitrable in nature. Disputes relating to rights and liabilities, which gives rights to criminal offenses, matrimonial disputes like divorce, etc., insolvency and winding up, because specially powers are given to the company law tribunal under IBC as well as under the Companies Act, succession, testamentary matters, tenancy matters. These are all certain provisions which are specifically stated in Booz Allen in Supreme Court. Winding up. Haryana Telecom case is a case where winding up is an arbitrable subject at all. No, it is not at all, because it is a special provision contained in the Companies Act. Sudarshan Chopra. Sudarshan Chopra, it was said that it is available, the right before the arbitrator and it was considered, the court was considering the powers of company law board and said the statutory jurisdiction upon the company law board and right of appeal cannot be ousted by consent of parties. Therefore, company law board retained jurisdiction. It cannot dismiss, Section 8 cannot be entertained. Similarly, Rakesh Malhotra versus Rajinder Malhotra. So this is another interesting case where the decision was taken that the rights and powers which are under 241, 242 are not available to the arbitral tribunal. Ministry of Sound International is another interesting decision which we often quote. Parties are not same and all, for frivolous purposes it cannot be. Even you can, when you get time, you read this case as well as the chloro control case. You can read some of these judgments. Vinod Kumar Bhavri is the latest 2017 NCLT Guwahati case where the Section 8 was allowed, because they found that there is no substance in the company petition saying that there is non-applicant petitioners, etc., etc. These are all certain provisions which always we use to refer. Before going there, I'll tell you about this Vaidyalingam Balaji refer is a case I have handled. I was for the petitioners. Respondents took out a Section 8. The Section 8 was for referring the parties to the arbitration. I said NCLT cannot refer the matter to arbitration. Section 8 was dismissed and it went in NCLAT. I argued before NCLAT also. NCLAT also agreed with our arguments. Judgment of NCLT was sustained. There was a case where NCLT retained jurisdiction, dismissed the Section 8. Supreme Court also dismissed it. Similarly, in Jubi Devasi also, I have argued, but this was a different one, where I said Section 8 must be allowed. And NCLT agreed with me, Section 8 was allowed. NCLAT, there is no appeal, because when an order is passed under Section 8, under the Arbitration Act, there is no provision for appealing against it under Section 7 until the arbitration is closed. So if Section 8 is allowed, there is no appeal before NCLT, because Section 8 is an arbitration matter. Under arbitration law, there is no appeal against the Section 8 order when arbitration is directed to be done. So this NCLAT referred to the decision in Tota Gurunath Reddy and others, which I have said already, Tota Reddy Singh. You can read there. This is about arbitration when Section 8 is allowed. Adjudicating authority is a judicial authority under in the Arbitration Act. Therefore, no provision for appeal before the NCLT. Now, I just want to mention only one thing here. See, principles of natural justice will be generally followed. CPC doesn't apply except in that, central government's power under 241.3, I have told you, where they have to take out an affidavit. Remember this. Another thing which you may have to remember is these are all the powers of civil court. vested in the NCLT, NCLAT, for example, summoning and enforcing the attendance of any person, examining them on oath, evidence, discovery of evidence, production of documents, receiving evidence, all these things are which are the powers conferred upon the NCLT, NCLAT, limited powers of civil court. Similarly, whenever an order is passed, it can be enforced as if it were a decree, and proceedings are judicial proceedings. Also, no civil court can have any jurisdiction in relation to any matter that is conferred upon the NCLT, NCLAT. 432, company secretaries, cast accountants, chartered accountants are entitled to appear. 433, limitation. Remember, Limitation Act shall also apply. So this is how I want to wind up my presentation. We can now listen to the organizers if there is anything that I need to take. It is already 10:05.
Sir, I must say this was an exception, and the deliberation made had made this enriched far more than our expectation. And I'm sure if a classroom session, we must have got our information from all across. But thanks for me on this particular aspect. It is showing. Sir, depending on your permit, then I will collect some of the questions what participants have raised.
Amit, before that, may I request Kondaya sir to answer, I mean, say something. Because yeah. I think I have answered Kondaya Jalada professor, his theme address.
Please, sir, please.
For want of time, of course, this is a subject where I can keep on arguing for hours and presenting it for hours today.
Sir, it was one of the wonderful presentations, because the real experiences covering all the aspects of the principles of the law, and you have given all the tips to all the budding lawyers, practitioners, how to build the case, how to write the plaint, how to collect the evidences, what happens in boardroom, sharing your practical experiences and development of jurisprudence, sir. It was really a new experience for me. I have learned a lot. So I have been the part of the cross-border private international law experiences, but I am very much thankful, sir, because if I get a chance again, I will invite you to our Aurangabad MNLU, one more session with our students also, because this is one of the upcoming area where the real practical area of the any company secretary or advocate everywhere, the client will come to us, sir, what to do? Which I did no wrong. Sometimes I did wrong what I have to do. So these are all actually very, very lucid way you have presented, sir. For that, I really appreciate it. Thank you, sir.
Amit?
Sir. Professor G, and it is direct, because you have done all these cases. So that is the way you have explained in a constructive manner. And no confusion at all, a lucid manner. Sir, one point about the arbitrability of operational mismanagement cases, and this Booz Allen case recently, High Court judgments, they are expressing the opinion that arbitration and operational mismanagement cases are not arbitrable. Recently, High Courts are expressing, and they are not following Booz Allen case. Even Booz Allen case, whatever express rights in rem and rights in personam, same position was is in England also. So, and what is their opinions? Anyway, finally, Supreme Court judgment, yes, will prevail over. And so right syndrome, the same principle should be followed, or recent High Court opinions deviating from the Supreme Court opinion, present mismanagement cases are not arbitrable. What is your opinion on it, sir?
Basically, the much would depend on the facts of the case. That is why I have brought to before this audience two types of cases I have argued. my personal experience, where in one Section 8 I have succeeded, dismissed the petition, asked the parties to go to the arbitration. In another Section 8, I succeeded by defeating the Section 8. Both have seen the line of first round, second round. So therefore, much would depend on the facts of the case. If you carefully analyze the matter which is complained of, need not be a matter which is supposed to be disregarded as non-arbitrable. It depends on the facts of the case. And I still say, in given facts and circumstances, I am sure Section 8 will be allowed. For example, an MOU or an agreement which covers all the management factors, all the management affairs, governance structures, MIS, financial statements, adoption, shareholding parity, directors' representation. What else you want? So parties have said, yes, we will go for arbitration. So my opinion is, much would depend on the facts of the case.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. We are grateful to you, sir, on my behalf and on behalf of RML NLU.
Sir, can we take a few of the questions which are most relevant, although you have answered, I think, most of the queries which are posted, but still for better clarity, we can take few. Rajesh is asking, can a preferential holder approach NCLT for operation and management? Yes, can. Manmohan is asking, can we apply to NCLT for removal of a director and selling his share to someone else when he is not ready to sign balance sheet and attending board meetings when there are only two directors?
Answer very much.
Manmohan. Yugal is asking, at times communicators face dispute with the director and other KMPs as many of them try to opt convoluted method of avoiding compliance. What remedy does communicators have under the Companies Act 2013?
The company secretary's case is different from shareholder rights. Company secretary is an individual. The best thing for company secretary is to disassociate with the company, whether practicing or company secretary in employment. But nothing prevents him from bringing to light to the regulators if there are frauds which are unconscionable. In his professional duty, a secretarial auditor may be liable to a duty bound to bring to the notice of the authorities frauds, if any, if they come to know during the course of the audit. So remedy under 241, 242 is not there. However, the CS can disassociate, resign from the scene, or if there is a mind-boggling, deep-rooted problems, he can take it to the regulator. If you remember 213, I have always argued for investigation. Tribunal has power so moto to order investigation. You don't need to be shareholder, you don't need to be creditor. You can present the matter on the facts. If it is justified, an investigation can be ordered.
And with similar rights, we also be a director shareholder.
Can you come back, Amit? It was not clear.
Sir, I'm asking, will the similar rights be available to the director who is not a shareholder? Because a similar situation arises in many of the cases among the directors. Yes, one non-executive is not holding.
It is there.
Narayana is asking, how other countries ensure fair play in corporate tax? Now, he explained, I think it is asking about the same thing what he explained. What is the, similar law in other jurisdictions also, or is it more different?
No, most of the jurisdictions have the same type of measures.
Okay. I think Prerna's question is on different. Jaydeep is asking, there are two directors in a private limited company. One director dies, one group holding majority shares would threaten the surviving director to transfer his shares to them. Majority shareholders are now trying to appoint a director of their choice. Remedy. What is the remedy?
You can, the legal representatives, legal heirs who are entitled to shares in consequence of death of a person can apply to the NCLT. Read Supreme Court in Claude Leela Parulekar.
Great, sir. Great. Section 242, subsection 3 and 7, 30 days point of time. Distinguish between the two sections, please.
No, next. Aage bado.
What are the rights of board of directors of public sector undertaking to apply before the tribunal? As stated, that directors per se don't have right unless and until they are the shareholder. So you will not be eligible. Sandeep is asking, if I am not a member but want to file a petition of getting the same under section 10, under if you are not member, the remedy is not there.
But 244, the NCLT has the right to waive all the conditions also, but case must be very, very serious and strong. For example, 213 can be approached instead of 241. Unless the case is very strong, you can't just like that go and ask for a waiver in I am a director and all, because basically the jurisdiction is members. It springs from rights of members. You rightly mentioned it.
Can a petition be maintainable against the person who is not a shareholder?
No issue. Normally in these cases, the persons in control of management are the...
Please, the question. What happens, suppose the previous shareholders got separated maybe 5 years back, and now the management wants to, the present management wants to invoke action of dismissal against that.
There is a limitation act now applicable, so you can't go after 5 years and then try to get relief. It is going to be removed, dismissed.
Non-convening of AGM and all these, are these grounds of operation?
As a single and isolated act, it will not be a case of operation.
Okay. If a company is under insolvency, can the operation petition be maintained?
Proceedings cannot be initiated against the company, basically because of the section 14. But I am of the view that the moratorium does not prevent cases of investigation under 213 or cases of mismanagement which is prejudicial to the interests of the company. The only point is the corporate debtor who is undergoing the corporate insolvency resolution process is already facing the prospect of challengeable transactions, for example, undervalued transactions, fraudulent transactions, any burdensome transactions, anything which is fraudulent preference. So therefore, at the time when insolvency resolution is taking place, promoters are ineligible to take control of the company even to become a resolution applicant unless it is MSME. If you go to the company law tribunal and tell director is changed or shareholding is changed 5% here and there, you yourself decide. That's what I want to say.
Yeah, I understood.
Yes.
How is winding up under 242(1) comparable to 248 and 271? 248 is not winding up. 271, yes, certainly. So you can throw some light. When you were saying perhaps to pass the test, that company is fit for winding up. I believe his question is to understand whether I have to meet the conditions of winding up under 271 or how we have to.
There is no, the 242(1) is not for enabling winding up. It is the jurisdiction itself is alternative to winding up. Fundamental principle is that it is not for winding up. The case, if does not justify winding up, there is no problem, there is no issue. If it justifies winding up, doesn't mean winding up is ordered. The court must also look at the second limb. Find out whether alternative remedy and relief can be granted. Only then it will interfere and give orders under 242.
Sir, next question is on the limitation. From which date the limitation starts? In case of cessation of a director or in case of a right issue of the shares?
The date on which the appointment removal issue has taken place. In some cases, you have to prove that you didn't have knowledge about it. For example, the case I said, The cessation was somewhere I believe January of a particular year, but form was filed in October of that year. So nobody was aware that the cessation was backdated and recorded.
Rightly. What are the remedies available to the third party against the transfer of property, as you were mentioning? Because we 41.
Third party may be added as a party in the this thing if there is any termination or setting aside of a property. Third party has to prove that he has purchased in good faith, he has paid valuable consent.
Yeah, as far as it is concerned, I believe if you have the merits and you fulfill the criteria, you can use the CIL also.
Correct.
The whole of section 59, oppression and misconduct, both are interconnected matters. I believe one of the very common ground of oppression may be 59 violation also.
Yeah, that particular area of rectification of register of members is a vast subject. We can talk from Gulab Roy case to any number of cases on this point. Even some of the cases are argued also. So there is a, generally we find that these two are connected, but independently also this rectification can be filed.
Yeah. Can any company assist its employee to purchase its shares and deduct salary as value of its share? Paluji is asking, as per section 2 and inspection of material document, can a member request a copy of the material document, say for example valuation report? Secondly, it can be asked, can the company convert public company to private company, alter article of association to restrict transfer of shares of minority shareholder without approval of the minority shareholder? I believe she is hinting from mystery matter.
Yeah, but articles are altered by a special resolution.
Yeah.
If you are aggrieved of that, you can approach, provided you have the eligibility.
Yeah.
Amit ji, hello. Amit?
Yeah.
With your permission, can I answer the question number 8? Question number 8.
Yes.
8. Sir,
8.
I will take that question. I am on the last question, and then we will discuss that 8 number. Sir, this is asking, under what situation oppression and mismanagement cases the tribunal may order for the closure of the company?
I don't think so. The purpose of jurisdiction is going to be defeated if the company is going to be ordered for closure. When there is a no dispute resolution, both the shareholders can, in a perfect deadlock, like Ibrahim Westbourne Galleries case, winding up may be the only remedy if they don't come to see eye to eye.
Dr. Kundaya, I believe you were talking about this question.
Yes, question number 8. Actually, it falls into the conflict of laws and international law. There are principles of choice of law and contracts. Parties can select a forum which is suitable them. Otherwise, we have the two theories, party autonomy theory, closed nexus theory. So if they have a party autonomy selected, if there is no choice of law selected, closed nexus theory will apply. They can refer to Wilt of Products case available in the Dicey and Morris conflict of laws. The choice of law contract is a completely different subject when you have the cross-border transactions. So in the absence of choice of law, in the selection of the choice of law, you have the big subject is there. So the question who has raised, it comes in the private international domain, but there is a settled law that is called law. If the contract is closely connected to one country, or execution of contract, delivery of goods are there, the nexus theory will apply. We have a lot of cases on that. So therefore they can refer. One of the landmark cases is the product case. That's what, there are two conventions are there. Rome Statute on Commercial Contracts, and we have the CISC, Convention on International Sale of Goods. At the end, we have to see that how the contract has been drafted. Just I want to compliment for the...
Thank you, Professor, for bringing that to our minds and addressing the query of the participant. With this, we come to end on the 8th day of the master class. I must once again acknowledge the great session delivered by Dr. Ravichandran sir. He has always been an awesome speaker as he was today. I have been listening to him for quite long time, and every time I hear him on the same subject, I learn so many new things. So was the day. I'm sure the session was beneficial to all the participants. So we certainly look forward to even more detailed deliberations on a very, very nitty-gritties and aspects, maybe some case laws, including the Tata mystery, the intricacies involved, as we have shared on the other different platforms as well. So maybe RLS University will arrange separate sessions for the same, and we will be privileged to hear you out again. One small announcement for the participants of tomorrow's session. We will be having a great session on audit and auditors. We will be having other than Mr. Sudhakar from Reliance Industries Limited to guide us and help us in understanding the subject. So with this, I will request if Dr. Vishalakshmi say that we will close the session. Or Professor Kodaiya, you can just mute the session and we will close the session for the day.
I thank the Dr. Ravichandran sir for his excellent speech. I also thank as for moderator and coordinator, you are doing a wonderful job putting the questions, etc. I also thank all the participants who are very keen and putting their questions, and live session is going on. Thousands of people are viewing in this particular COVID-19 situation where the corporate law is reaching to every person. So I thank the organizers who initiated this program. I thank one and all who participated in this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Ravichandran sir, Dr. Vishalakshi. All the participants, see you tomorrow morning at 7 a.m.
Okay.